be welcome and let's enjoy the commemoration, after which we're going to have a culture show in Walubilis. So the party will continue this afternoon. So, mesdames, je vous souhaite les bienvenus. Et nous allons commencer avec le symposium ici. Après, nous allons à Walubilis pour la fête culturelle. To start this afternoon, we're going to have Ivorian singer, Madame Dobe, who is accompanied by a group of young migrants helped by the ASBL Exil, whose members are here in the room. And they will be singing the ACP anthem. And with them, we have Sierra Leonean singer, Xavier, and members of the ACP staff, Dr. Natalie Corricorders and Madame Eva O'Reilly. Mesdames et messieurs, pour les hymnes de ACP, nous avons Madame Dobe Nahore de Côte d'Ivoire, qui est accompagnée par les jeunes migrants et les membres des staff. So, ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to our singers, and may I ask you to please stand up for the ACP anthem. Veuillez vous lever s'il vous plaît pour les hymnes ACP.
ACP, 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 l'espoir est renouvelé, les chemins s'élargissent davantage. Lorsque le monde s'éprend de liberté, lorsque l'on cultive les sillons de la solidarité, l'aube se rapproche au son de l'unité. Sur le socle de la communion de nos peuples, flottera le drapeau qui nous guidera. ACP, 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 ah, ACP, 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 l'espoir est renouvelé, les chemins s'élargissent davantage. Lorsque le monde s'éprend de liberté, lorsque l'on cultive les sillons de la solidarité, l'aube se rapproche au son de l'unité. Sur le socle de la communion de nos peuples, flottera le drapeau qui nous guidera. ACP, 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 ah, ACP, 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 nous sommes la voix d'une raison, d'une histoire qui trouve sa source dans cette chanson. L'expression de nos rêves et de nos désirs d'aller de l'avant et de vivre dans un monde d'amour et de paix. ACP, ACP, ACP.
Merci.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. So, ladies and gentlemen, to start the afternoon, I would like to welcome His Excellency Ambassador Roy Mickey Joy, Ambassador of Vanuatu, and the Chairman of
Thank you, Madam. Thank you, Dr. Pindo, for your excellent words of sentiment and in being given this responsibility to coordinate and manage this important event. The Honorable Minister for Foreign Affairs of the Union of Comoros, Your Excellency Dr. Abdullah Gari Mohamed, Your Excellency Monsieur Gadre Desire Guadrago, President of ECOWAS, from ECOWAS Commission and former Dean, as well as former Chair of the ACP Committee of Ambassadors. Ambassador, it's a pleasure and an honor to welcome you back to the ACP House. I recognize our former Dean, Ambassador Sack Pro from Togo. He's supposed to be with us this afternoon. I understand in a recent discussion just a few minutes ago, he told me he's got appointments to see his doctor, and I hope he'll be able to join us at the course of the day. Excellencies, and allow me also to welcome all the prominent guests around here who've accepted our invitation, but I would like to pay particular attention to Ambassador Guinnessy from Mauritius, who's with us, former Ambassador of Mauritius in Brussels and formerly Dean. Also, Ambassador Nebinda, formerly ASG of this house from Burundi. Welcome, sir. I also wanted to welcome my good friend, Monsieur Arsil Basiliken, who's with us this afternoon. And my apologies for those who have not been able to mention your names. But distinguished guests, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, friends, today marks a very important day on the occasion of the birth of the ACB Group of States. I would like to welcome you all to the celebrations marking the 40th anniversary of the founding of the ACB Group of States in my mere capacity as your Chair of the Committee of Ambassadors. Colleagues, I use the word celebrations deliberately because over the past 40 years, we as a group registered significant successes, not least in making our modest contribution towards uplifting the livelihoods of our people in our nations, in our six regions of the entire ACB diaspora. Ladies and gentlemen, the magnificent art and photos exhibition mounted downstairs in our ACP house bears testimony to this unique relationship and friendship that we've built over the last 40 years. It would, however, also be fair to say that we have encountered a few challenges along the way. The 40-year anniversary, therefore, provides a good opportunity to not only celebrate our successes, but also reflect on the challenges and ideals we've encountered and lessons learned as we chart our future, particularly as we leverage our strengths towards enhancing the effectiveness of our AC Group as a global player. The ACB Group, colleagues, Honorable Minister, Ambassadors, Excellencies and colleagues around the table, in the next day or two, on the 6th of June in 1975, in the country of Guyana, in the capital of Georgetown, the ACB Group was actually formally conceived. So yes, we've come along. We've come 40 years. In this house, through the Committee of Ambassadors, there's regular discussions and reflection about the future of our group. I'd like also to share with you that in the course of the celebration, we as citizens, as nationals, as proud citizens of ACP, must be able to share with us what is the future of our group. Because where I come from, in the small Pacific Island countries, originally there were only three countries of Samoa, Tonga and Fiji that were members of the original Georgetown Agreement. Some of us joined during the course of the past Lome negotiations. But fortunately, in the advent of the Cotonou Agreement, There is now 15 of us. And on that note, I also wanted to welcome my colleague Ambassador Fale Maraka from the Pastrican Forum, who comes all the way from the BIF office in Geneva, representing our Secretary General, who could not be able to be with us this afternoon for pressing reasons. So, Secretary General, that gives you the apology from our region. Over the course of this afternoon, colleagues, and all of tomorrow, therefore, we will examine these issues together with our partners and regional configurations, as moderated by my colleague ambassadors. Let me hasten, however, to reassure this August gathering that it will not only be work over the 2 days. To start with, the various research sessions of the symposium will be interspersed with cultural interludes that bring to the fore one of our greatest strengths in ACP, our cultural unity and diversity. Furthermore, as the program indicates, a buffet lunch will be offered by our embassies and missions tomorrow afternoon, thus availing this August gathering of the culinary delights hailing from the African continent, Caribbean, as well as the Pacific. To my mind, however, the highlight of the celebrations would be the cocktail reception and cultural spectacle to be held at the nearby Wallabies Cultural Center immediately after the symposium this afternoon. Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it would be a remiss of me not to be able to formally and once again congratulate Dr. Patrick Gomes from Guyana, our new Secretary General, his new team of management, and of course, the vision and the spirit whereby Dr. Gomes is spearheading certain reforms in the ACP Secretariat. Just last week, between Tuesday and Wednesday, we had the privilege of convening our 101 session of the ACP Council, followed subsequently by the 40th session of the joint ACP-EU Council of Ministers. And I wanted to share with you that despite the number of major obstacles, ACP through the joint council made some significant landmark and decisions that we'll be able to assist this group after 40 years to move our secretariat forward in terms of its global participation in events of relevance to our group. As we have a full program ahead of us, colleagues, allow me to stop here so we can get into business of the day proper. But before I do that, I would like to pay tribute to SG, as I mentioned, and his team. My appreciation also extends to my colleague, the Distinguished Ambassador of Chad, who's here with us, who just the task force for the commemoration of the 40th anniversary, as well as the representatives from the ACB regions in the task force. Ambassador of Chad, you have my blessed support, and we are glad that your participation in leadership can be able to culminate in a successful opening of this for the anniversary this afternoon. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me welcome you once again to the 40th anniversary celebrations of the ACB group, and I thank you for your kind attention and for accepting the invitation from DSG to be part of this important celebration. Thank you very much.
Affairs of Comoros, who is with us this afternoon, His Excellency Dr. Abdul Karim Mohamed, to say a few words of welcome. Excellency, please.
Excellences, messieurs les ambassadeurs, monsieur le secrétaire général, je suis particulièrement heureux aujourd'hui d'être parmi vous pour célébrer les 40 ans d'existence de notre organisation. Les ACP, pour mon pays, est une famille dont nous sommes fiers d'en faire partie. Et c'est pour cela que mon pays a souhaité, à travers ma présence, témoigner sa solidarité. Je suis particulièrement heureux parce que mon pays, l'Union des Comores, est justement jeune, de cette organisation de seulement un mois. Nous avons acquis notre indépendance seulement le 6 juillet 1975. Donc dans un mois, nous allons aussi fêter les 40 ans de notre indépendance. Par ailleurs, je félicite l'organisation, en fait le secrétaire général pour cette organisation, pour la pertinence des thèmes retenus, sachant que nous sommes actuellement en train de réfléchir sur l'agenda post-2015 pour le développement. Donc les thèmes retenus cadrent bien avec ce calendrier mondial. Je n'avais pas prévu de parler, donc je ne vais pas trop m'éterniser parce qu'on a un peu grignoté sur le temps pour que je puisse intervenir, donc je ne veux pas monopoliser la parole, mais je ne peux pas abandonner le micro sans féliciter le secrétaire général pour ses nouvelles fonctions et lui souhaiter beaucoup de réussite dans ses nouvelles, dans ses missions. J'en appelle à tout le monde pour finir, pour plus de solidarité et que vive la coopération internationale. Je vous remercie.
And for this, I'll hand over to our moderator. But before we do that, we'll ask for a few minutes to reorganize the high table to bring our next speakers. So may I hand over to our moderator, His Excellency Ambassador Samuel Jefferson Chandler, Ambassador of Barbados. Sir, please.
Well, good afternoon and welcome as well. And I take it my chairman has made all the various remarks and so on, so we can go straight into the meeting. That makes my task much easier. But we must admit that this session will be dealing with really regional perspectives for the future. We here, over some months, in fact years, have been looking in the group. We had a working group on the future perspectives of the ACP. So we have done some work. In fact, we reported to the ministers in December. But what we want now from this distinguished gathering, we might not have got all that we could have got. And the jury is still out because there's a group called the Eminent Persons Group, which is still to report. So we would be very happy to get any additional perspectives which you may have, certainly so that we can incorporate whenever the summit of the ACP is held. Of course, that is being hoped that can be held this year. And if it is being held this year, well then, certainly if we get these perspectives for the future, regional perspectives, which we have not been able to get in the working group, or even in the Eminent Persons Group, we will be very grateful. Now, there are four topics here which we'll be looking at, and all of them look from the particular perspective depending on the regional group. So we should be able to get a very rich and diverse, and I hope we would also have corresponding or perspectives that all merge together, even if they are not all. So the first topic is the challenges of small developing states in the Pacific and the relations with other ACP states. I who have come also from Barbados, I'm from a said state, I can tell you that this, we do not take this topic lightly, because it is a challenging topic, and indeed, even our development partners, at least some of them, are now recognizing the seriousness of the situation, not only writing it and walking away, but they are recognizing the seriousness of the situation. So without any more ado, I would like to call on His Excellency Mayor Fallon Maker, the Permanent Secretary of the Pacific Islands Forum, Secretary in Geneva, to give us his perspective. Sorry, Herb.
Thank you very much, distinguished Ambassador. Honorable Minister, distinguished ambassadors and members of the ACP states, distinguished chair of the Committee of Ambassadors, the Secretary General of the ACP, His Excellency Ambassador Patrick Gomez, the heads of the ACP regional integration organizations, representatives of the European Union, development partners, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen and friends. Let me first of all extend to you all the sincere apologies of the Secretary General of the Pacific Islands Forum, Dame Meg Taylor, for not being able to join you on this joyous occasion of the 40th anniversary of the ACP Group, owing to pressing prior commitments in the region. Second, I wish to also convey her warm congratulations to you, Mr. Secretary General, Ambassador Gomez, for your recent appointment to this high office, and to sincerely thank you for your kind invitation to make this statement on behalf of the Pacific States. So before I begin, may I convey to all to you all our usual warm Pacific greetings. The Pacific Islands Forum, as we have heard from the distinguished moderator, was invited to speak on the topic, the challenges of small island developing states in the Pacific and relations with ACP states, under the overall theme, regional perspectives for the future. The topic is indeed timely and relevant. It allowed us in the Pacific to relook at the challenges that we face as seats and to assess our relations with other ACP states, but more importantly, to think seriously about our future together as the ACP and the related issue of the future of the ACP group and its relations with the European Union beyond Cotonou. I will outline briefly the challenges of the Pacific seats and perhaps share how these challenges are being addressed. Then I will share the Pacific perspectives on how we see the relations with the ACP in the future. Indeed, it has been a very long journey since the Georgetown Agreement was signed 40 years ago, and while the membership of the ACP has grown considerably since then, so too are the number and the complexity of issues that we have confronted together. As a region, the Pacific states face numerous shared challenges, from managing our oceans, our vast oceans and fisheries resources, our land-based natural resources, and in trying to manage and mitigate the effects of climate change. Economic development remains elusive for the large part across the region, while dependence on development assistance remains high in some parts of our region. As small island developing states, or SIDS, the challenges confronting the Pacific also stem from their natural and structural characteristics. Their small size with limited natural resources places limits on our development options. Coupled with isolation and our fragmented islands, this raises significant costs on our development. Our smallness prevents economies of scale, foster reliance on a few export products, and as small open economies are highly susceptible to external economic shocks. Our reliance on imported fossil fuels and high transportation costs add to the high cost of doing business in the islands and make the Pacific uncompetitive on the global stage. On the social side, the Pacific is also seeing the rise in non-communicable diseases brought about by modernization, changing lifestyles, and a high dependence on imported food. We also face a growing youth population and rising unemployment. But perhaps the most pressing challenge of our time facing the Pacific is climate change, which is increasing in frequency and intensity, as we have recently seen with Cyclone Pam in Vanuatu. The rising sea level caused by climate change is threatening the very existence of some of the low-lying Pacific states, their food security, and also undermines the sustainable development of the Pacific seas. In terms of the regional responses, over the years, the Pacific has been responding to these challenges individually and collectively through regional cooperation initiatives. The Pacific Plan, adopted by forum leaders in 2005 and revised in 2007, was one of those initiatives which aimed at enhancing and strengthening economic growth, sustainable development, good governance, and security in the Pacific countries. At the apex of this is to foster sustained economic growth in the Pacific countries through sustainable trade and investment, improved infrastructure development, and increasing private sector contribution to the economy. Regional trade integration was one of the main vehicles to catalyze growth, which saw the conclusion of the Pacific Island Countries Trade Agreement in 2001, the negotiation of the Economic Partnership Agreement with the European Union, and the negotiation of a closer economic relations with Australia and New Zealand, called PESA Plus. These are expected to increase trade and investment, create employment opportunities, and contribute to economic growth. To overcome transport and energy challenges, the Pacific countries have also embarked on innovative solutions such as regional, sub-regional shipping franchise schemes, moving to renewable energy for all through a number of technical regional organizations in the Pacific. On climate change, the Pacific countries are also working collaboratively to build climate resilience through adaptation and mitigation programs through a number of regional agencies in the Pacific. All of this initiative combined could contribute to the sustainable development of the Pacific seas. However, all of these initiatives are being reviewed along with any emerging issue in the context of a new framework for Pacific regionalism, which was mandated by the Pacific Islands Forum leaders in 2014. The framework for Pacific regionalism provides an opportunity to work towards the deeper form of regionalism that was always envisaged under the Pacific Plan. A regionalism that would acknowledge and recognize our shared challenges, draw on our shared strengths, build the political will to act collectively, and devise and carry out effective collective solutions to these challenges, whether through technical or political means. It is important to recognize that regionalism cannot on its own be pursued, but must be about improving the lives of the people of the Pacific. The four principles that underpin the framework are the emphasis on focused political conversations by leaders on the region's issues, the need for changes to the regional architecture to ensure a more coordinated, effective, and efficient regional architecture accountable to its members, enhancing greater inclusiveness by encouraging all members of the Pacific community, including the private sector and civil society, to contribute to the region's priorities. And four, a shift in the development paradigm where leaders will determine and have full ownership of the region's political, social, economic, and development priorities. The framework of Pacific regionalism aims to develop a stronger integrated Pacific that is dynamic and responsive to the needs of its members. Let me turn to the relations between the Pacific and the ACP. The world that we live in today is far different from the world in which the Georgetown Agreement was signed four decades ago. And the Pacific recognizes that regionalism alone is not sufficient to address the complex and numerous challenges that we face. Many of these challenges require action and solutions at the regional and international level, and the scope for stronger relations between the Pacific and the ACP states will grow in importance. as I said, the challenges faced by the Pacific Seeds are not new. They are shared with other small island developing states in the Caribbean and in the Indian Ocean Commission. They are well recognized. In fact, the Barbados Plan of Action of 1994, the Mauritius Strategy, and the more recently Samoa Pathway that was agreed last year at the United Nations International Conference on Seeds bear testimony to the fact that seeds remain a special case for sustainable development in recognition of their vulnerability to economic and environmental shocks. These instruments represent a global response to the vulnerability of seeds. The greatest challenge, however, is for the Pacific and the seeds as a group to see how to translate these commitments, these international commitments, into practical solutions or actions that addresses their sustainable development goals. Herein is what we see as the importance of the ACP group and the relations between the Pacific and the ACP group. The ACP must remain relevant in these changing times. The ACP, the Pacific values its relationship with the ACP states, as our diversity and solidarity are also our strength. The ACP also is probably international institution outside of the UN, which is the home of most of the small island states. That is, the small island states of the Caribbean, of the Indian Ocean, and also the Pacific. Therefore, the ACP must, as I said, remain relevant to addressing the sustainable development of the seeds. The Pacific therefore welcomes the decision that was made recently to establish a seeds forum within the ACP as a mechanism that will start to translate some of these international commitments into action in order to address the challenges facing the Pacific seeds. The Pacific also looks to the ACP to strengthen intra-ACP relations beyond simple cooperation, to include trade, investment, and private sector development. This would add strength to the regional integration efforts in the ACP region. The ACP relations, the Pacific also considers ACP relations of critical importance, given the ACP's role in our relationship with the EU, which remains of paramount importance to the Pacific states. While the Economic Partnership Agreement has recently become one of the cornerstones of our relations with the EU, we remain cautious that this should not be used to divide the ACP states, and the ACP-EU relations go beyond trade cooperation to broader elements of economic and political cooperation. The ACP therefore remains a significant institution in this relationship with the European Union. The Pacific also welcomes the process that has recently been agreed, as alluded to by the distinguished chairman of the Committee of Ambassadors, to start the process of the future perspectives of the relationship between the ACP and the European Union beyond the Cotonou. The Pacific, perhaps, are too small to be able to attract the attention of the larger players around us. If you look at the Pacific, we are right next door to the economic powerhouses of Asia, Southeast Asia, and East Asia, and the Europe and the United States on the other side. Here again, we see the importance of the ACP group to start to leverage strategic partnerships that can bring small island states that really do not matter to most of the world powers to engage effectively and constructively in addressing their concerns. The Pacific also sees the importance of the ACP as an important additional and influential voice for the ACP, including the seeds, in the global forum. This we have seen clearly in the Geneva process. The ACP group is a well-recognized body, a group in the negotiations in the WTO. And at the same time, we recognize that the ACP can usefully use that weight in the other global decision-making fora that are about to take place this year. As we have seen, this year is a significant year for the global community, with the launching of the SDG in September, the climate change meeting in Paris in December, and the World Trade Organization Ministerial Conference 10, also in Nairobi in December. The need for coherence in global decision-making across all these international institutions need to contribute to the sustainable development efforts of the ACP, including the seeds. We need to draw attention to the challenges that we face together as a group in areas that support the development of our capacity, the importance of our key priorities, for example, in the area of trade financing and climate financing, to develop our capacity to respond better to climate change, to respond better and take advantage of trade opportunities that we can take advantage of. So here are some of the reflections that we bring this afternoon to this table. And as we reflect together as a group over the 40 years that we have journeyed together and look forward to the perspectives of our new relationship with Europe, may we wish you success in our deliberations. Thank you.
Cannot say that we haven't got some perspectives, at least from the SIDS and the SIDS specific. We go to the other topic, which we was, in fact we have to skip that topic because the person who is to give his delivery is held up, but hopes to come later. So we will go to the third topic, which is EPAS as a development tool, institutional and implementation issues in the Caribbean. And as you note, I think most of us know that the Caribbean has a full EPA, has signed a full EPA, and we're in the process of implementation. And I have said more than once that all is not well, although we are not giving up hope. So that you will now hear it from not only from me, but from other people in the Caribbean. Who best to hear it from is Dr. Percival Murray, who is the Director General of the CARI Forum, and who is really at the helm of this EPA process. So we now hear from him.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For my sins, Mr. Chairman, I am in fact the coordinator of EPA implementation in the Caribbean. Mr. Chairman, Honorable Minister, Chairman of the Committee of Ambassadors, Secretary General of the ACP, other members of the head table, ambassadors, invited guests, colleagues. The theme for your 40th anniversary is From Georgetown to Sipupo. Yesterday, I traveled from Georgetown to Brussels. I traveled from Georgetown to Brussels to speak to you on behalf of the Secretary General of CARI Forum, His Excellency Erwin LaRocque, who is unable to be with us today and who has asked me as Director General to deputize on his behalf. He would have wished to have been with you, but that unfortunately was not possible. Today, I may sound a little bit negative. That is by the very nature of the subject that I was given to speak about. I was asked to speak about institutional and implementation issues on IPA implementation, and I will do my very best to tell you what these issues are from a Caribbean perspective. As you're aware, an economic partnership agreement between CARIFORUM states and the European Union and its member states was signed on October 15, 2008. The agreement was provisionally applied as of 29 December 2008. Please note that I was careful to indicate between whom that agreement was signed. It is the European Union and its member states, whilst on the part of CARIFORUM, they signed as individual states, so that the contract is between the individual states of the Caribbean and the European Union and its individual member states. I say that because I will make the link to issues that I am to identify. The last meeting of the Trade and Development Committee, which is the technical body overseeing implementation of the IPA, noted that 7 CARIFORUM states and 16 EU states had ratified the agreement to date. I think at least one additional state has ratified since that time. And of course, Croatia has acceded to the EU, and that creates another issue that I will identify. All CARIFORUM states which are parties to the agreement, except Haiti, are provisionally implementing the IPA. Haiti is the only Caribbean state which is a party to the agreement, which is not yet applying the agreement. And note that I'm saying Caribbean states party to the agreement, because Cuba is a member of CARIFORUM, but is not a party to the Economic Partnership Agreement. The CARIFORUM EU-IPA was negotiated and signed on the premise that it would be a mechanism and tool for promoting the sustainable development of CARIFORUM states. The joint declaration on the signing of the IPA provides for a comprehensive review of the agreement by the parties, and I quote, not later than 5 years after the date of signature, and at 5 yearly intervals in order to determine the impact of the agreement, including the cost and the consequences of implementation. The parties also, and I quote again, undertake to amend its provisions and adjust their application as necessary. That 5-year process, review process, is ongoing and will be the major item on a CARIFORUM EU Joint Council of Ministers meeting to be held in Georgetown, Guyana, on the 16th of July, 2015. The Joint Council will benefit from a study entitled Monitoring the Implementation and Results of the CARIFORUM EU IPA, commissioned by the EU, and a study undertaken by the UN Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean on behalf of CARIFORUM. A summary of the findings of both these studies informs this presentation on institutional and implementation issues of the CARIFORUM EU IPA. I want to start with the identification of the issues by describing for you what we have concluded to be the national institutional and implementation issues. A number of institutional and implementation issues challenge CARIFORUM member states in respect of the IPA. I will give you a sample of those issues. The first issue is the limited human and financial resources to effectively coordinate the implementation of IPA-related activities. This is manifested in a number of forms. These forms include limited technical capacities in key technical areas in the public sector, for example, on those matters related to standards. limited capacity to coordinate implementation across various disciplines. And again, that is reflected by very small or no national IPA coordination units. Each country ought to have established a national IPA implementation unit. I could say to you that very few countries have done so because of the manpower and financial limitations. And what we have found is that persons and technicians with other responsibilities have had IPA implementation added to their functions. So frankly, some of them do consider coordination of IPA implementation an additional burden. And so the assignment doesn't really get the kind of technical emphasis and dedicated coordination which it ought to have been receiving. There is a limited capacity in designated inquiry points and or competent authorities. Each country has to establish its competent authority. Frankly, again, it is an existing agency or institution which is designated to take on these additional functions, most times without additional resources, financial or manpower. And then there is a limited legislative drafting capacities in all of our member states. Now, if we are to fulfill our obligations under the IPA in a number of instances, this requires significant changes in existing legislation and the legal drafting capacities and the limitations thereof that we experience, in fact, constrains the rate at which we can in fact put into place legislation and regulations intended to honor our obligations under the IPA. At the national level, there is another set of issues that challenge us, and that is the absence of certain technical institutions at the national level. You would be surprised if I say to you that some of our countries do not even have a National Bureau of Standards. And if you cannot meet the quality standards for export of goods, then whatever market access you have cannot be translated into market presence. And so the IPA is of limited meaning under such circumstances. Some of our countries do not have competition authorities. They do not have public procurement authorities. The intellectual property rights organizations are in their nascent stages. And we have obligations in all of those areas that we're not able to fulfill simply because, in some instances, the institutions to look after those matters simply do not exist. It is not that we don't have the capacities. The institutions are just not there. And so we are unable to give the kind of attention that such matters require. Where such national technical institutions exist, there are limitations in their capacity. For example, where we have national institutions looking at the quality infrastructure, there are certification problems. In that, you know, we cannot afford to put in specialized certification authorities in each one of our member states. It simply does not make economic sense to do that. And so we have that inadequacy in matters related to certification, particularly for export purposes. And then there are weaknesses in national institutions which provide support to the private sector. Frankly, if we are to benefit from the IPA, it is the private sector, in most cases, that will be the mechanism for us obtaining the relevant benefits. But we can say to you that there are issues in that area. For example, in the area of services, we have agreed that we would use the mechanism of national coalitions of services to advance in terms of development and export of services. All of these institutions are either nascent, very weak, and in some cases do not exist, so that there is no support organization for the promotion and development of services. Generally, they are very weak private sector support organizations in some countries, so that the private sector has no assistance on the basis of which it can, in fact, organize itself to take advantage of the provisions of the agreement. Then there is the inadequate arrangement for development financing for the private sector. Frankly, in the absence of such financing and in the absence of research and innovation capacities, the IPA will remain a challenge to us and to our private sectors. I want to move quickly to regional, institutional, and implementation issues. Let me give you a background. CARIFORUM states signed the IPA in their individual capacities. The regional approach to the facilitation of IPA implementation is intended to yield economies of scale and for CARIFORUM to pool scarce manpower and institutional resources to face common challenges and issues. However, CARIFORUM is not an integration grouping. It is a cooperation grouping. Most of the members, however, belong to CARICOM, which is an integration grouping. You can see how this introduces a certain level of complication in designing CARIFORUM regional approaches to development and to developing and using regional institutional capacities to facilitate IPA implementation. On the one hand, CARIFORUM is a cooperation grouping, and on the other hand, CARICOM is an integration grouping, so that most of the specialized institutions that exist at the regional level are CARICOM institutions and do not have a CARIFORUM-wide mandate or remit. So that is a level of institutional, built-in institutional challenge that we face. Those, some of the challenges that I will describe at the regional level mirror those challenges that I have described for the national level. Limited human and financial resources for IPA coordination is a dominant issue. My office is responsible for the coordination of IPA implementation in the region, and I could tell you that I have four professional staff members, one lawyer, one services expert, a director, and I've just lost my trade in goods expert and my services expert. So in fact, provisions are made for five, but I have three. And you'll be amazed if I told you, well, you probably won't be, but I will tell you that the operations of the unit are almost 100% financed by grant resources from the EU. And so you could well understand that the focus of attention of that unit is built into the design of the grant agreement that we must negotiate with the EU. And I don't think I have to tell you anything more than that. It will tell you that our focus is on meeting obligations and commitments rather than taking advantage of the provisions of the IPA. The financial limitations constrain the kind of support that the member states can give to us, and it also constrains the kind of work that we can undertake. In fact, for us to have made meaningful input into the EU-financed exercise on the five-year review, we had to seek the support of the UN Economic Commission for Latin America and the Caribbean, because we did not have the in-house capacity, neither did we have the finances on the basis of which to purchase independent and external technical resources. We have no capacity in assisting states to implement measures which we ourselves advise or which require external financing or additional economic support. So you could understand the kind of challenges that we face from a regional perspective when we cannot even assist the member states in implementing some of the recommendations that we ourselves would make to them from a technical perspective. There is also capacity limitations in other existing regional institutions. I want to give you some examples as I quickly go through what kinds of challenges we have. Caribbean Export Development Agency is the CARIFORUM Trade and Private Sector Development Agency. It faces severe financial constraints and has limited manpower. It depends on the EU for more than 50% of its finances, and we're desperately trying to diversify its sources of financing. But you know what? Whatever the global community says about untied aid, in practice, we have difficulty in attracting resources other than EU sources to develop capacity related to developing exports to the EU. And so I add that qualification to the debate on untied aid. That is our practical experience. Then there is also the limited capacity of the regional coalition of services, which is intended to promote and develop export services. These, the national nodes do not receive the kind of financial or other support that they ought to have been receiving from the member states. So there's a pervasive weakness in that network. The financial and technical capacity constraints of the Caribbean Regional Organization for Standards and Quality, on whom we depend to pool our resources for certification purposes, to link us with centers of excellence on standards, is kind of severe. The financial constraint is severe. In fact, Friday, they probably would have presented their budget to the Council of Ministers. And I could say to you that there are severe constraints. If I were to give you an anecdotal example, I remember going to a high-level political meeting at which a decision was made to establish a regional organization, which I will not name. The decision was made at that meeting. The instruments were signed at that meeting. The institution came into existence at that meeting. But the government's representative reported to the meeting that they were unable to finance its first annual budget. Now, that tells you the level of capacity constraints facing the regional institutions. Similar challenges are faced by the Caribbean Competition Commission, and there is an absence of competition bodies in some of our member states. There was also severe institutional constraints within the Caribbean Association of Investment Promotion Agencies. In addition, there exists only limited scope organizations dealing with intellectual property rights, and where they exist, they face severe constraints. There is also an absence of regional bodies on the basis of which to negotiate mutual recognition agreements with counterparts in EU member states. Now I come to the point of the EU and the individual member states with the EU. For those of you familiar with the Economic Partnership Agreement, you will realize that to get access for professional services in the EU market, you literally have to negotiate with the professional bodies in each individual EU member state, because the EU tells you and the Commission tells you that it does not have competence in those matters, and that those matters rest within the national jurisdictions of each individual EU member state. So we cannot negotiate with one EU body. We have to establish a regional organization for that particular profession, for example, architects, engineers, or consultants. And then we have to go to each individual EU member state to negotiate a mutual recognition agreement with that professional body, on the basis of which we may attempt to sell our services in the EU market. Frankly, we do not even have some of those professional bodies at a regional level. So we have to establish them, build capacity, and then engage in negotiations with individual EU member states. Imagine the scope of the challenge that we face in the region. And of course, there is the inadequacy of the transport facilities for intra and extra regional trade. That I won't dwell upon. My colleague from the Pacific has aptly described the Caribbean situation. Then there are some CARIFORUM EU institutional implementation issues that I want to talk quickly about. There are issues built into the agreement itself. I have just described one, that in the area of professional and other services, that the EU itself does not have competence and that we're required to do negotiation with EU member states. And that, for me, is a systemic issue that has to be addressed one way or another. There is the problem of the fact that most EU commitments or a number of EU commitments in the agreement are in fact best endeavor provisions, and it makes it extremely difficult for us to monitor or measure the efficiency of implementation of those best endeavors. Another area that constitutes a built-in area that constitutes some challenge for us is the trade with the EU outermost regions that continue to apply what is called the octroi de mer, which we consider to be a discriminatory tax. Now, the agreement grandfathers some kind of provision which permits the French overseas countries or outermost regions to apply certain taxes. And for us, that is a built-in systemic problem that prohibits us from expanding our trade with our immediate neighbors. I come from a small island called Dominica, and on either side of Dominica, Martinique and Guadeloupe, two French countries, but we have trade limitations amongst ourselves. I have to report in all honesty that my people are innovative and have found numerous ways in which they can trade with their colleagues and neighbors in the French overseas countries and territories. We're innovative and we will find ways to do what we have to do. In addition, the issue of development cooperation within the IPA itself poses an implementation challenge. You know what? We've been advised that development cooperation between CARIFORUM and EU is governed by Cotonou. So that even if we took on additional obligations and commitments under the IPA itself does not provide development cooperation support from the EU. In fact, what has happened over time is that we've had to dedicate a significant part of our traditional regional indicative program financed by the European Development Fund to IPA implementation. I have to say in all honesty that in recent times, the EU has in fact significantly increased its contribution to the Caribbean Regional Indicative Program. But when we check and we make estimates of the cost of IPA implementation, sometimes we ask, what have we got ourselves into? And then I want to go very quickly to the joint institutions of the IPA. The joint institutions of the IPA provide avenues for dialogue and consultation between CARIFORUM and the EU on IPA implementation. The status of their operations and the level of CARIFORUM participation in their operations provide another perspective on the status of implementation of the agreement itself. I could say to you that the list of arbitrators that ought to be appointed under the agreement, which was provisionally applied since 2008, has not yet been finalized in 2015, so that nothing can be sent to arbitration. The consultative committee, which is civil society component of the agreement, was not established until November 2014. And of course, CARIFORUM will face financing and manpower challenges as it relates to a secretariat to service and provide support for effective participation in CARIFORUM in that consultative committee. Similar challenges face the CARIFORUM EU Joint Parliamentary Committee. We do not have a CARIFORUM Parliamentary Committee. We do not have a secretariat for CARIFORUM EU Parliamentary Committee. And so effective participation in that joint body provides us with an additional challenge. The Trade and Development Committee is much better in that it comprises senior trade officials from member states. And so we are able to harness their capacities to do work intended to inform our participation in such a committee. But you imagine the cost when the EU is in the chair and such meetings are held in Brussels. I mean, I like to come to Brussels, but 15 of us traveling to attend one meeting is kind of exorbitant and expensive. The Joint Council is the supreme body, and it will meet in July 2015 under the chairmanship of CARIFORUM. It will meet again in Georgetown, Guyana. So a lot is happening in Guyana. We're going back to our roots. In summary, and in conclusion, I want to say to you that the technical studies undertaken and the ongoing consultations on the five-year review of the IPA all conclude that the IPA has not yet delivered the range and scope of benefits which were anticipated. Of course, there are differences of opinion in the reasons for that situation. From my presentation, you could tell what the Caribbean's opinion on the matter is. One thing is clear. The relative emphasis has been placed on CARIFORUM states meeting their obligations under the agreement as against deriving benefits from the agreement. The available information suggests that the institutional capacity limitations at national and regional levels have constrained CARIFORUM in meeting all its obligations under the IPA. Similar limitations, as well as on the supply side, have negatively affected our capacity to take advantage of the provisions of the IPA. That situation is compounded by the built-in challenges of the agreement as they relate to development and trade in services between CARIFORUM and the EU. The joint institutions of the IPA have all been established, but effective CARIFORUM participation will be challenged by financial and technical capacity constraints. The absence of a permanent mechanism for continuous monitoring of the IPA is one pervasive institutional weakness of the IPA. Unless that is changed, review and evaluation will be periodic, historical, and ad hoc, and not timely enough to address challenges and constraints on a real-time basis. The CARIFORUM EU IPA has tremendous potential for contributing to the sustainable development of CARIFORUM states. Attention must, however, be paid to the institutional and capacity constraints, the built-in constraints of the agreement, CARIFORUM's supply-side capacity constraints, measures negatively affecting the development of and trade in services and effective CARIFORUM participation in the joint institutions of the IPA for the true potential benefits of the IPA to be realized. The ongoing five-year review process gives reason for hope. Thank you very much.
This is a lot to digest, and I think this is a good time to have our break, and I would hand the floor back over to our dear sister for any announcements. Thank you.
Thank you, Excellency. Ladies and gentlemen. competition. The band was born out of a vision and determination of Trinidadians living in the Notting Hill area to share their culture and to introduce the culture of steel band and carnival to the local youths in their communities. So we're going to see them here this afternoon, just a prelude, because you're going to be watching the whole band playing for much of the time this afternoon in Walubilis. So ladies and gentlemen, please give them a warm welcome. Thank you.
Well, this was just a preview of what to come, so we hope that you will join us in the other celebrations which we have. Now, we have had some very, we heard two interventions already, and they were very full of the items for which we could debate, and I thought it would be better, instead of going on, to have a debate for the next 15-20 minutes on the two presentations that were made, lest you forget them, because they're very important. So I open the floor now for any interventions, any comments that you would want to make and we are all among friends here, so don't be afraid to express how you see things. The floor is open. We have to take it that the two interventions, despite the fact that they might have sparked some controversy, well, not controversy, may have sparked some very eyebrows in terms of particularly of the Caribbean, IPA, where everybody probably thought that it was going rosy and dandy, because sometimes the EU would want us to want their audience when they speak to believe that is so, but you hear it from the coordinator himself, so that you would have to rely on my one-sided view, and I have been most of the time putting the case up here in ACP. But if that is okay, we can go on. If you don't have any comments at all, we can go on. So we will go on now to the other panelists, which is peace. Oh yes, South Africa. At least South Africa has a question.
Well, thanks very much, Chairperson, and let me take this opportunity to thank the Secretariat for putting together this very impressive event on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of the ACP. I'm quite certain that when we rise tomorrow, we would have taken full stock of the lessons of the last 40 years, the present and the future challenges. Chairperson, I would like to thank the Director General of CARI Forum for a very candid, a very frank, but also a rather dim, a rather worrying assessment, appraisal of the last 7 years, 6 years or so of the implementation of the IPAs in the Caribbean. I worry and agonize about what he has said, because when I look at some of our countries that have still to implement this agreement, I think they will be faced with the similar challenges, similar constraints that the esteemed DG has highlighted. Now, I'm quite keen to know, with the experience that he has generated over the last few years, how is the Caribbean region, how are the Caribbean states going to overcome some of these challenges? What is the strategy to address some of these challenges? And I think we need to take note of some of these issues, particularly the capacity constraints related to the inadequacy of our institutions, our bureaus of standards, our trade and investment bureaus, our competition authorities, which are very key in terms of facilitating the trade between ourselves and the EU, but also in terms of making sure that we take full advantage of these agreements. Now, with the challenges that we also have, which are similar to the Caribbean, I worry a lot because it doesn't seem to me that we have a strategy, even those of us who have not yet implemented these agreements. A preemptive strategy, or rather proactive strategy, of how to overcome and deal with some of these challenges ahead of the implementation of the EPAS. Thank you.
The person who asked for the floor, could you also identify yourself?
My name is Langston Cumberbatch, former ambassador of Trinidad and Tobago to this institution, and also subsequently director of the Trade.com PMU that was established by the European Commission to help ACP countries expand their trade. After about 3 years of implementation, by the Caribbean countries, I being a Trinidadian myself and former ambassador to the ACP here, I took it upon myself to invite a dozen leaders of Caribbean countries to embark on a visit to Europe, having done first the study to try to find out why no advances or successes seem to have emerged as a result of our signing this agreement. And the members of the private sector, who are fairly well endowed in Trinidad, I thought the people who could possibly derive advantage from the APA, and we went to Germany, to Cologne and to Munich. We went to Rotterdam and to the UK and established contact with private sector, their counterparts in Europe. Had useful meetings, everyone was satisfied on both sides. Subsequently, after their return, 2-3 months after the return, I called to find out what progress had been made, had any contracts followed, any positive developments emerged. And I regret to tell you I am yet to be informed of the existence of any perhaps I needed to have tried again, but the result was negative. Nothing had emerged. So there is a lot of work to do, not only from securing the appropriate institutional mechanisms and finance from the Commission, or colleague from CARICOM was telling us, but from our private sector to get them invited, interested, and determined to pursue the efforts to achieve some benefit from these APAs. The APAs, in my view, were not necessarily at fault at that time, but we needed to generate, to motivate our business community to access what opportunities they might benefit from in the European markets. I thank you.
Good afternoon, Excellencies. My name is Mariama Williams. I'm from the South Center. Right. Just a small remark, I think. I really want to thank the Honorable DG from CARI Forum for his really frank and open assessment, because I think it is from those starting points that we can actually make progress. And I think for reason many of us in the room might have been quiet, is the bracing and kind of, in a way, shocking, even though many of us had ideas and some prediction, but to hear it and the details of it is quite amazing, and it's quite stunning. But I'm struck that this is not particular to the EPA, and that it raises serious lessons for us and for ACP as we move forward into the post-2015 period, because we are still involved in making obligations, whether it's on the post-2015 SDGs or now in the climate change, that we have not fully come to grip with what the implications are in terms of the nitty-gritty of those implementation. And so I think the lesson that we need to think is, it draws, how do we move forward beyond in the future, and how do we tackle those issues of capacity building, market access, which don't deliver by itself, but requires other kinds of things. And so I think it's a discussion that we'll have in the next days. But just to say that, I think many of us are still trying to absorb the reality of the actual concrete verification of some suspicions that we might have had.
To Marie, to respond to the question, is someone else? They can't see.
Right next to you. Yes, please.
Yes. Guinea-Bissau, the ambassador.
Je vous remercie.
I'm sorry. Just wait a minute.
Gentlemen. Je peux? Monsieur le Président, je vous remercie. Et mon nom est Alpha Nyaki Bari. Je suis un produit, entre guillemets, tant de la Commission européenne, parce que c'est là où j'étais stagiaire, et ensuite commencé ma carrière d'expert, et ensuite la convention de Yaoundé, je suis le dernier secrétaire général de Yaoundé, et ensuite le groupe ACP, je suis un produit véritablement de la maison ACP. Le groupe ACP est caractérisé par son unité. Mais j'ai été surpris par la désunion du groupe dans cette affaire, dans la stratégie d'approche des APE. Et je voudrais que monsieur le secrétaire général ou le président, que vous m'éclairiez pourquoi cette dynamique unitaire qui a toujours été, qui a symbolisé le groupe depuis sa naissance en 75 jusqu'en 85-90, s'est dilué au fur et à mesure que le groupe prend entre guillemets de l'âge. Alors c'est pour cela que je suis un peu déçu. Et d'autant plus que les APE nous, de l'extérieur, ont s'interrogé. Et le représentant des Caraïbes vient de nous donner quelques illustrations de ce qui pourrait nous attendre. Alors, est-ce qu'il n'est pas temps que le groupe ACP se ressaisisse en un bloc et revoie un peu comment ensemble vous pouvez mener ce combat ensemble et non divisé comme vous l'êtes actuellement face à ce problème des APE? Je vous remercie.
Ambassador from Guinea-Bissau, please.
Je vous remercie, Monsieur le Président de la Commission de la CEDEAO, Communauté des États de l'Afrique de l'Ouest, Monsieur le Secrétaire Général, distingués invités, Mesdames, Messieurs, en vos titres, grades et qualités. Nous sommes très heureux d'être ici cet après-midi pour célébrer, comme il a été suggéré ici, un événement qui a eu lieu il y a 40 ans et qui depuis a transcendé les horizons, les options, les espoirs pour féconder cette union dont vient de parler M. Barry, à partir d'une notion fondamentale qui est celle de la solidarité. Monsieur le Président, Monsieur le Modérateur, lorsque la troisième conférence au sommet ACP s'est tenue à Nadi, Fidji, le thème central était solidarité ACP dans un monde globalisé. Déjà en 2002, 13 ans plus tard, les choses n'ont pas changé, sinon pour se compliquer davantage, en tout cas en ce qui nous concerne. Monsieur le Président, si j'ai demandé à prendre la parole, c'est parce que, comme d'aucuns l'ont fait remarquer ici, nous avons entendu avec beaucoup d'intérêt l'intervention du directeur général de CARIFORUM, qui nous a fait part d'une expérience vécue, réelle. Vous-même, vous n'avez de cesse, en tant que représentant de la Barbade, de nous rappeler les insuffisances, les écueils, les difficultés auxquelles votre groupe est confronté dans la mise en place des mécanismes devant vous conduire à la pleine jouissance des résultats qui sont attendus, qui sont légitimement attendus de la coopération avec l'Union européenne au travers des APE. Monsieur le Président, je concède aux préopinants qu'à partir de l'analyse qui a été faite par Monsieur Percival, on serait tenté de croire que nous sommes invités à nous lancer dans une aventure périlleuse. Or, donc, je voudrais faire remarquer que nous, en tout cas, en ce qui nous concerne, nous qui sommes de l'Afrique de l'Ouest, nous avons, me semble-t-il, le président de la Commission est ici, il est plus autorisé que moi, plus connaisseur des tenants et des aboutissants, mais qu'il me permette de croire que nous avons procédé à une approche totalement différente, dans la mesure où il ne s'est pas agi de négocier individuellement, mais nous avons négocié au travers d'une organisation qui est à la fois une organisation d'intégration et de coopération. Et c'est là une différence fondamentale. Le caractère binaire qui existe dans les Caraïbes et qui fait qu'il existe d'un côté le CARICOM et de l'autre le CARIFORUM et de l'autre le CARICOM suscite, sinon est même la source de certaines difficultés auxquelles nos collègues de cette région sont confrontés. Moi, je veux bien que nous en tirions des leçons, que son intervention nous serve d'alerte, nous serve de balisage, mais je ne voudrais pas que nous partions d'ici avec le sentiment pessimiste que les APE ne sont rien du tout, sinon des sources de problèmes supplémentaires, puisque nous en avons déjà assez, individuellement et collectivement. Moi, je crois que s'agissant d'une expérience nouvelle, il faudra, mutatis mutandis, s'adapter, apporter les corrections, envisager ce qu'il convient de faire, parce que c'est une expérience nouvelle pour nous comme pour les Européens. Mais en tout état de cause, l'essence même de cette nouvelle logique de coopération qui se fonde sur les échanges commerciaux, plutôt que sur la main tendue qui attend de manière impassible qu'on lui apporte ce dont elle a besoin cette main. Je crois qu'il s'agit de faire en sorte qu'au travers d'un partenariat actif, gagnant-gagnant, nous puissions asseoir un mécanisme qui réponde à l'attente de nos populations. Certes, dans nos pays aussi de l'Afrique de l'Ouest, il y a des interrogations. Mais c'est tout à fait normal. Et je crois que nous devons envisager l'avenir avec beaucoup plus d'optimisme et surtout avec une détermination et une volonté qui ne doit être jamais démentie. Je crois que c'est sur cette note que je voudrais terminer. Certes, il y a beaucoup de choses à apprendre et nous avons retenu des leçons, certes intéressantes, mais je ne crois pas que cela puisse être un élément décourageant puisque nous avons la volonté de poursuivre dans la voie du dialogue, de la coopération, de la négociation pour, comme je l'ai indiqué, asseoir une coopération mutuellement fructueuse et bénéfique. Je vous remercie.
Just before I give the floor to Mr. Murray, I just want to say, I guess each region may be somewhat unique. Certainly the Caribbean has its uniqueness. Besides Trinidad and Tobago, and perhaps Jamaica and a little bit Guyana, really these are service economies. They don't, in terms of trade, you wouldn't expect goods coming from them in any valued amount. And I think the point that Mr. Murray was making, particularly with the service economies, and indeed, that is tourism and financial services. We do not have much leeway as far as the EPAs are concerned, but he will, I'm sure, expand on it. And so, without any more ado, I want to give him the floor, ask him to bear in mind what South Africa has asked, the point that Trinidad was making, and indeed, the Guinea-Bissau. Thank you. Of course, the comments made by things generic.
Mr. Chairman, I will attempt to discuss some of the issues that have been raised, not necessarily respond. I want to start with the very last one first. You will recall when I introduced my subject, I specifically indicated that the subject that I was asked to address was institutional issues related to implementation. And so I gave an expose on the issues. That is not to say that I cannot point to some success stories. I could ask you, for example, to examine the trade performance of the Dominican Republic, for example, and you will note that that is the only country that may have had a genuine increase in its trade with Europe under the EPA. I could say to you that the figures for Trinidad and Tobago show some improvement, but this is due primarily to fossil fuel exports from Trinidad. I can tell you that in each of our member states, there are anecdotal examples of success stories, both in terms of goods and services. So I want to qualify my statement by giving that indication that there are success stories that can be pointed to. So it's a beginning, and that is why I was careful to say that the general conclusion is that the EPAs have not yet yielded the benefits that we think that they can give. I also concluded by indicating that I thought it was an important development tool for the region with the potential to yield significant support to our economies. So I thought I should start by making that general statement before I went on to provide clarification on the other issues. How do we address those challenges? The first thing we have to do is determine whether the EPA is a priority for us. Because sometimes we get the feeling as technical officers, I'm speaking as a technician now, that priority interest is not placed on IPA implementation by some of our governments. Now, that is clear. When you take into account the fact that you cannot put dedicated technical officers, even within the limits of your small public service, to look at some, if it was considered as an essential element of the development of the country, the relevant resources would have been made available. That is my view. And so the treatment received at the national level, in my view, is reflective of the importance or lack thereof that is placed on the IPA by the individual member states. There's no doubt in my mind about that. So first we have to start with putting IPA in its proper perspective. Then the second thing that we have to do, which we're trying to do in the region, is that we have to take IPA as one of the trade agreements that we have to implement. And so we have to design a strategy, especially when it comes to build capacity, that when we build capacity for one, we build capacity for all. So that we build capacity in terms of our own regional integration movement, capacity that is relevant to our ability to engage in international trade. We're now negotiating an agreement with Canada. And so what capacity we build for the IPA should also be relevant to the capacity that we build for trade with Canada and the U.S. Under the Caribbean Basin and other initiatives. We also have partial scope agreements with countries like Mexico, Brazil, and some of our Latin American neighbors. In other words, what I'm saying is that we have to address our capacity constraints within this global context. What do we need to put in place to improve our efficiency in terms of our international trade? That both in goods and services, in my view, that is how we need to begin to approach the capacity constraint problems, and we're beginning to do that. What we have tried to do now at the CARICOM level, they've just agreed on a 5-year strategic plan, and that involves a review of some of the existing institutions to see if they're fit for purpose. Some of them may have been established 20 and 30 years ago. Their mandates have not changed with time. Their source of financing and mechanism for financing may be outdated. So we're also trying to undertake a review of our existing regional institutions within the context of this 5-year strategic plan at the CARICOM level. And we will be examining each institution to determine whether it's fit for purpose, what it contributes to the collective effort, and how to finance that institution. So that's another strategy that we're attempting to put into place. We're also trying to diversify our source of financing for some of the regional institutions. And it is in that context that we place our capacity building within a global context. So we go to the Inter-American Development Bank, for example, and say to them that when you build capacity or help us build capacity, it is not specifically related to the European Union and ought not to be a European Union burden, but you're assisting us in building capacity for other purposes. So that's the strategy that we're using. We're trying to deal with some of the constraining factors, like the transportation issues, by addressing maritime transport and port facilitation through regional projects so that we can get the economies of scale. We're trying to establish transportation networks. We're also looking at sources of funding for our transport and trade facilitation infrastructure by using blending of grant resources with commercial financing to see how far we can stretch the grant euro or dollar that is provided to us by combining it with commercial resources to deal with some of the limitations of our transport infrastructure particularly. On the matter of the visit to Europe and the lack of interest shown by some of our private sector people. Let me be blunt and brutal on that. Some of our private sector people say it's too difficult to do business with Europe. North America is our neighbor. We will focus and concentrate our efforts there. That is part of the problem. We're closer to the United States and Canada. And the regulations sometimes are not as all-embracing as the EU regulations. And so some of our people prefer to focus their energies on the North American market. We are attempting, through public and other education programs, to bring to them the potential benefits of the EPA. In fact, I have a specialist on public education and information in my unit who is charged specifically with doing that, to try and sensitize the private sector as to the opportunities that may be available for them there. And the person who made the comment about the difficulties that we have not been specific to the EPA, that is correct. It is part of the structural difficulties and the capacity difficulty that we have as countries on our general development and export development thrust. Clearly is an indication of the state of our economy, the resources available to us, our level of development and our vulnerability. I'm tying everything back to our vulnerability. Because frankly, let me put it this way to you. The government of Grenada, for example, can spend 200 million euros building a port this year. And next year, it may have to spend 100 million additional repairing that port, because one hurricane lasting 5 hours has visited that country. And so we're always rebuilding. And frankly, we have money to do very little else. And that is something that we go out and argue. The other issues related to the solidarity of the ACP, I leave that to those more competent in that matter than myself.
Tell you that Mr. Gorman, Lawrence Tatz was out, but she has now joined us.
No, a representative is here.
Oh, yes. A representative has come, and he will give us a brief intervention on the whole question of progress towards deeper integration, the experience of SADC, so we can complete the regional perspective. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chairperson, Honorable Ministers, Your Excellency, Secretary General of the ACP, Your Excellency, Chairman of the Council of Ambassadors, Excellencies and distinguished guests. The Executive Secretary of SADC has mandated me, I think I should say, who really is not very far from here and would have wanted and thought she was going to be able to come and address you. But that is not possible because she is in another meeting. So she mandated me to come here and read her statement. And this is what I'm going to do. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it is our singular honor and privilege to be able to participate and address you at this historic occasion, which affords an opportunity for reflection on progress of the ICP states and regions, of the progress they have made in the past 4 decades. The Southern African Development Community, SADC, is delighted to participate in the celebration of the achievements of the ACP group of states and regions, especially at this time when we are also reflecting on the future of the group. In this context, I'm honored to share with you the SADC experience and progress that it has made towards deeper regional economic integration. I hope that our collective experience as ICPs and subregions, both in terms of the achievements and challenges we have faced, will assist us to review our performance over the past 40 years and reflect on how to reposition the ACP group in the future in such a way that it can effectively respond to our needs in the 21st century. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, SADC's program for regional economic integration has been guided by its regional indicative strategic development plan, which since 2005 has set out the region's programs for deeper economic integration in various areas of development, including infrastructure, trade and industrialization, finance, and agriculture. Progress has been varied, and notable amongst the achievements was the establishment of the free trade area in 2008, when a minimum of 85% of tariffs on goods were zero rated by countries implementing the SADC protocol on trade. Maximum tariff liberalization for most of our FTA members was attained in 2012 when tariffs on sensitive products were removed. Intra-SADC trade increased substantially following the implementation of the FTA between 2000 and 2012 grew fourfold in absolute terms. In SADC, we are, however, cognizant that these figures still reflect depressed and unbalanced levels of intra-regional trade, which has remained at roughly 15% in relation to total trade with the world for the same period. These comparatively low levels of intra-regional trade have been ascribed to failure by the region to significantly participate in global manufacturing production networks and value chains or create this regionally. The SADC region is endowed with abundant natural resources, especially in mining and agriculture, but we continue to export unprocessed products which are subjected to the vagaries of fluctuations in commodity prices. Under such circumstances, trade liberalization alone will not lead to sustainable socioeconomic transformation and lift the millions of our people from poverty. In order to reverse this trend, SADC recently took the decision to focus on adding value and beneficiating our natural resources. In this context, SADC Summit of Heads of State and Government approved a revised Regional Indicative Strategic Development Plan for 2015-2020 in April 2015. The revised RISDP places industrial development at the center stage of regional economic integration in the SADC region, with a view to accelerating production and deeper, more sustainable market integration, able to deliver equitable benefits to our people. In tandem with this, SADC also developed a regional industrialization strategy and roadmap, which was approved by the SADC Summit of Heads of State and Government in the same meeting in April. The strategy has a long-term perspective with a three-phase period covering 2015 to 2063, aiming at socio-economic and technological transformation, putting value chains, beneficiation, and competitiveness at the center stage of the regional economic integration process. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, you may already be aware that in few days, SADC together with COMESA and East African Community, will, as part of the tripartite arrangement, launch the tripartite free trade area encompassing 26 countries with a combined population of 625 million people and a gross domestic product of 1.2 billion, constituting half of the African Union's membership and 58% of the continent's GDP. This will easily make this Africa's largest economic bloc and will indeed be a good platform for the establishment of the continental free trade area, whose negotiations will be launching at the 25th African Union Summit to be held in Johannesburg, South Africa, from the 14th to 15th of June 2015. Let me take this opportunity to mention that over the years, going as far back as its formative years, regional cooperation and integration in SADC has always been premised on the need to address the infrastructure challenges that we face and negatively impact on the ability of our members to adequately and comprehensively address poverty eradication. SADC has in that regard developed a 15-year regional industrial development master plan as a strategic framework built on a foundation of harmonized policies and a joint pool of resources, and establish specific targets for addressing challenges under six infrastructure pillars, namely energy, transport, information and communication technology, meteorology, transboundary water resources, and tourism. This is an ambitious plan which is aligned with the Program for Infrastructure Development in Africa, PIDA, the Common Market for Eastern and Southern Africa, COMESA, East African Community, SADC Interregional Infrastructure Master Plan, as well as other initiatives. Like the Presidential Infrastructure Championing Initiative aimed at accelerating continental infrastructure projects identified by PIDA, it is expected to cost more than USD 350 billion and approximately US 65 billion with prioritized project in the short-term action plan. To a great extent, resources are to come from private sector investors. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, let me also touch on the area of agriculture and food security, where demand still outstrips supply. And as a result, the region remains reliant on imports. During the last season, most SADC member states recorded an increase in agriculture production, with a regional surplus recorded for maize, while the other main cereals were all in deficit. Livestock production has been increasing by about 4% annually in the past five years. People requiring humanitarian assistance remain high in the region. Despite the general increase in food supply and availability observed over the past few years, the SADC Food and Nutrition Security Strategy and the SADC Regional Agriculture Policy have therefore been adopted to inter alia promote availability of food through improved production, productivity, and competitiveness as part of implementation of the Dar es Salaam Declaration of SADC Heads of State on Agriculture and Food Security in 2004. Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, as highlighted on development in these areas, the road towards sustainable regional economic integration is still a very long one. While some progress has been made in some areas, SADC member states still face a number of challenges in terms of achieving deeper regional economic integration and participating in the multilateral trading system. SCP countries as a whole now face new challenges which they have to measure up to, including the development of value chains and mega-regional intercontinental trade arrangements, among other things. When the final report on the future of the ACP is finally presented to the next ACP summit, let it comprehensively address the need for any future arrangement to partner itself in substantive way with work being done in the various sub-regions on economic integration. For us in SADC, it is important that this relevance is premised on lifting the region to get high heights in terms of participation in global value chains, value addition and beneficiation to our natural resources. Whilst they also consolidate relationship with our existing partners, it is also important that we forge new partnerships with emerging countries and economic groups. I wish to conclude the statement of my boss by reiterating SADC's continued commitment to deepening regional and continental integration and cooperation. As we reflect on the past 40 years of the founding of the ACP Group, we also look to the future and commit ourselves to the renewed partnership with reinvigorated ACP, which will offer us a platform of choice for more meaningful interaction on the rapidly evolving global stage. I once again thank you, Chairperson, for the opportunity to address this audience. I thank you very much.
We thank the representative from SADC, and we will go straight on before we have any more discussion. And because one of our speakers has to leave to get back to Geneva, we would give him the floor first, and that is from ECOWAS. He is His Excellency Cadre Désiré Ouédraogo. I hope I call your name right. Good. You have the floor. Ensuring the financial sustainability of international organizations.
Okay. Thank you. Excellence, Ambassadeur Roy Mikey Joy, président du comité des ambassadeurs des ACP, Ambassadeur Patrick Gomez, secrétaire général du groupe des ACP, Ambassadeur Samuel Chandler, modérateur, ambassadeur de Barbade, Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs les ambassadeurs, Mesdames et Messieurs les présidents d'institutions, distinguées personnalités ici présentes, Mesdames et Messieurs, permettez-moi avant tout propos de dire ma reconnaissance au secrétaire général des ACP et à travers lui au groupe ACP pour nous avoir invités à ce symposium et nous y avoir accueillis avec tant d'égards. Je voudrais surtout remercier l'ambassadeur Gomez, non seulement pour son profond attachement aux idéaux du groupe ACP et sa contribution à sa consolidation, mais aussi pour l'occasion qu'il me donne ainsi de revoir tant d'amis que je compte dans cette belle ville de Bruxelles. En vous réitérant ici, mon cher frère et ami Gomez, mes chaleureuses félicitations pour cette initiative du symposium, je voudrais surtout vous exprimer ma gratitude pour l'honneur que vous faites à la communauté économique des États de l'Afrique de l'Ouest en l'associant à cette commémoration du 40e anniversaire de la création du groupe ACP. Il y a 6 jours de cela, le 28 mai dernier précisément, la CEDEAO fêtait également ses 40 ans d'existence. Cette heureuse coïncidence dans l'histoire et l'évolution de nos deux organisations nous offre simplement l'occasion d'établir un parallèle sur les chemins parcourus et d'envisager les perspectives de consolidation de nos différents processus d'intégration et de développement. C'est pourquoi, au-delà du plaisir que j'ai à me retrouver au sein de ce groupe, dans cette maison qui m'est familière, je voudrais saluer la pertinence du choix du thème de ce symposium qui nous permettra à coup sûr de décliner les différentes facettes qui font la force et qui feront l'avenir du groupe ACP. 1975-2015, que de progrès, que d'innovation, mais aussi de défis pour la consolidation du groupe et sa coopération avec l'Europe. Permettez-moi de rendre hommage à tous ceux qui ont été les pionniers et les continuateurs de cette belle aventure. Ayant personnellement eu le privilège de présider le groupe de travail sur l'avenir des ACP, je mesure le défi permanent que représente sa dynamisation et sa consolidation. C'est dire que je suis particulièrement heureux de pouvoir contribuer aux discussions de ce forum en partageant avec vous l'expérience de la CEDEAO sur la problématique de la viabilité financière des organisations internationales. C'est le thème qu'il m'a été demandé de traiter. Excellences, mesdames et messieurs, en mettant en exergue le renforcement des relations ACP-UE, la déclaration de Sipopo sur la situation du groupe ACP à l'horizon 2015 et au-delà a souligné à juste titre l'impérieuse nécessité de la diversification des partenariats dans la poursuite des objectifs du groupe et la réalisation du développement durable de ses pays membres. Cette orientation souligne, si besoin en était encore, l'importance de la coopération intra-ACP et de la pérennité financière du groupe dans la conduite efficace de sa mission et l'atteinte de ses objectifs. À ce niveau de mon propos, il me semble opportun de relever 3 certitudes que nous partageons d'ailleurs tous ici et qui sous-entendent la démarche de la CEDEAO dans le financement de son processus d'intégration. D'abord, la question du financement du développement à long terme renvoie à la nécessité de disposer de ressources propres qui offrent aux économies des pays ACP une plus grande marge de manœuvre dans la conduite et la maîtrise de leur processus de développement. Ensuite, les contributions statutaires, y compris les ressources extérieures, quoique nécessaires, sont parfois inadaptées ou insuffisantes par rapport à l'accroissement des besoins de financement des organisations, besoins inhérents à l'évolution de leur mandat. Enfin, les multiples défis, qu'ils soient économiques, sociaux, politiques, sécuritaires, auxquels nos organisations sont confrontées, nécessitent dans leur relèvement des ressources adéquates et suffisantes pour y faire face en toutes circonstances. Excellences, mesdames et messieurs, vous conviendrez donc avec moi que la viabilité financière des organisations telles que les nôtres renvoie à un certain nombre de principes clés, à savoir l'autonomie, la prévisibilité, la durabilité, l'équité et l'appropriation. C'est à l'aune de ces principes que la CEDEAO, pour répondre durablement aux problèmes de financement de ses programmes, a adopté en 1996 le protocole sur le prélèvement communautaire, dont le taux est fixé à 0,5% de la valeur des marchandises importées des pays tiers et qui est reversée directement à la commission de la CEDEAO. Ce mécanisme de financement a permis à l'organisation de se soustraire définitivement des aléas de contributions directes des États membres à partir de leurs budgets nationaux. Il a surtout permis non seulement d'éponger leurs arriérés de contribution, mais aussi de générer les ressources nécessaires pour financer les différents programmes de la communauté et assurer le bon fonctionnement des institutions. Le mécanisme du prélèvement communautaire est suivi par un comité de gestion regroupant les services de la Commission et les administrations financières des États membres. La CEDEAO, grâce au prélèvement communautaire, arrive aujourd'hui à financer en moyenne plus de 85% de ses activités, la part des financements extérieurs étant de moins de 15%. Ce résultat encourageant a permis le renforcement de la crédibilité de la CEDEAO et son positionnement comme un interlocuteur de taille dans le cadre de la coopération multilatérale. On peut donc se féliciter des résultats tangibles obtenus ces dernières années grâce aux efforts collectifs des États membres dans la mobilisation des ressources. Toutefois, force est de reconnaître la récurrence de certains défis relatifs notamment à l'harmonisation des modalités pratiques et de la mise en œuvre du protocole. Nous avons, pour relever ces défis, engagé une série de mesures politiques, techniques, de suivi et de coordination et de renforcement des capacités. Le mécanisme a été passé en revue lors des réunions statutaires de la CEDEAO qui se sont tenues le mois dernier à Accra. Excellences, Mesdames et Messieurs, à travers ce bref aperçu de l'expérience de la CEDEAO, il apparaît de toute évidence que la viabilité financière des organisations suppose d'abord la volonté politique des États et leur engagement à respecter et à honorer leurs obligations communautaires. La viabilité financière des organisations, c'est aussi la capacité des États à créer un environnement favorable à l'investissement et à faire des réformes économiques, notamment des finances publiques. La viabilité financière des organisations, c'est également la gestion rationnelle des ressources et l'application des normes et principes d'orthodoxie reconnus en la matière. La viabilité financière des organisations, c'est enfin la diversification des sources de financement et le renforcement de la coopération Sud-Sud. Monsieur le Président du Comité des ambassadeurs, Monsieur le Secrétaire général du groupe ACP, Mesdames et Messieurs les ambassadeurs, je voudrais vous réitérer ici l'attachement profond des pays de la CEDEAO aux idéaux du groupe ACP, dont les actions ont permis de renforcer la coopération Sud-Sud. Permettez-moi aussi de vous dire toute ma conviction que cette coopération Sud-Sud reste un levier important pour la diversification et la transformation des économies des pays ACP. Elle doit par conséquent être au service de leur développement. C'est pourquoi, dans la négociation des accords de partenariat économique régionaux de l'Afrique de l'Ouest, nous avons tenu à préserver la coopération Sud-Sud. Je me félicite des actions entreprises d'ores et déjà par le groupe ACP pour renforcer les instruments de cette coopération en vue de les rendre plus performants. Je me félicite également des orientations éclairées du Conseil des ministres ACP pour la mise en place des fonds et mécanismes appropriés destinés à assurer la pérennité et la réussite du groupe ACP. C'est le lieu pour moi de saluer l'action d'un illustre fils de notre région, Son Excellence le Président Olusegun Obasanjo, à la tête du panel de haut niveau qui va matérialiser les idéaux des accords de Georgetown créant le groupe ACP. je ne saurais terminer mon propos sans rappeler les relations anciennes entre la CEDEAO et le groupe ACP. En effet, notre région de l'Afrique de l'Ouest a eu l'honneur d'accueillir par 4 fois les cérémonies de signature des conventions successives de Lomé, ainsi que celle de l'accord de partenariat de Cotonou. C'est assurément cette coopération historique et de longue date que je veux saluer ici et qui, une fois encore, s'est récemment illustrée à travers la solidarité et l'accompagnement des États ACP en soutien aux efforts de l'Afrique de l'Ouest dans la lutte contre l'épidémie de la maladie à virus Ebola. En particulier, je voudrais réitérer notre profonde gratitude à la République de Cuba pour l'assistance apportée aux 3 pays les plus durement touchés durant cette épreuve. C'est à travers ces mots de reconnaissance à tous les États ACP que je veux renouveler ma gratitude au secrétaire général pour sa contribution à un avenir meilleur du groupe ACP. Je renouvelle mes félicitations à l'ensemble du groupe pour les 40 ans de l'accord de Georgetown et l'expression de la solidarité des pays membres de la CEDEAO envers le groupe ACP. Vive le groupe ACP, vive la coopération Sud-Sud. Je vous remercie de votre aimable attention.
We thank the president of the ECOWAS Commission for his intervention and for his kind words. And of course, you can see the love he had for the place he has left. Now, we want this one final speaker, and that is the one on the peace as a prerequisite for successful regional and ACP cooperation. The other speaker, strengthening ACP cooperation through interregional dialogue, wouldn't be here with us. He is at another meeting, I think. So this will be the last statement. And this is from Daniel Pascal Elono. Daniel Pascal Elono, you have the floor.
Je veux parler en français. Excellence, Monsieur l'ambassadeur et président de la séance, j'ai l'honneur de prendre la parole cet après-midi au nom du secrétaire général de la CAC, son excellence Monsieur Ahmad Alami, qui aurait bien voulu être des nôtres ce soir, mais qui a été empêché par d'autres obligations. La CAC ainsi remercie le groupe ACP de l'avoir choisi pour présenter, pour faire cet exposé sur le thème de la paix et j'ajoute la sécurité parce que généralement les deux vont ensemble. Je ne sais pas pourquoi les organisateurs ont voulu que les autres communautés économiques régionales ne parlent que de ce qui concerne leur communauté et de donner la compétence à la CEAC de parler de la paix en général, puisque vous voyez bien dans le programme qu'il n'est pas dit que c'est des questions de paix dans l'espace CEAC. Ça veut dire que c'est global, donc l'ensemble des pays ACP. En tout cas, nous avons pris cela comme étant un grand honneur. Cela va nous amener donc à parler un peu d'une manière générale de la paix. Et moi, j'ajoute de la sécurité, parce que les deux, je le rappelais, vont toujours ensemble dans le cadre du groupe ACP. Comme vous le savez, les pays de la CEAC ont toujours joué un rôle important dans le groupe ACP. La dernière preuve en date, c'est l'organisation réussie du sommet de Malabo en 2014. Donc, J'ai déjà eu à présenter les excuses et les regrets du secrétaire général. Pour nous, en présentant ce thème, il s'agit de souligner, et nous nous en réjouissons d'ailleurs, que le groupe ACP a mis un accent particulier sur les régions, ou les sous-régions, comme vous voulez, notamment en Afrique, où nous avons 5 grandes sous-régions et qui, finalement, correspondent aux grandes organisations d'intégration sous-régionale que nous avons en Afrique, à savoir la SADC, la CEAC, la CDAO, l'Union du Maghreb arabe, l'IGAD et les autres, en tout cas les 8 qui sont reconnus par l'Union africaine. Donc pour nous, aujourd'hui, les communautés économiques régionales ont un rôle capital à jouer dans tout ce que nous voulons entreprendre. Et vous voyez bien, ceux qui m'ont précédé ont parlé des accords de partenariat économique. Et beaucoup d'autres programmes de l'Union européenne se mènent dans le cadre justement de ces communautés économiques régionales. Cela était déjà au niveau de l'Afrique, parce que je veux peut-être m'excuser de beaucoup plus parler de l'Afrique. Mais vous savez que l'Afrique est le plus grand groupe dans le cadre du groupe ACP. Mais en plus, c'est la région qui connaît le plus les problèmes de paix et de sécurité. Parce que autant les îles du Pacifique et les Caraïbes ont des problèmes, mais au niveau de la paix et de la sécurité, c'est essentiellement le continent africain. Donc, à partir de ce constat, nous pouvons entrer très directement dans le vif du thème qui nous a été proposé, à savoir la paix, une condition indispensable pour une coopération régionale et ACP réussie, je veux dire. Il n'est pas question pour nous ici de venir nous interroger à nouveau sur les fondements épistémologiques et ontologiques d'un thème qui est connu de tous, qu'est la paix. Mais comme je l'ai dit tout à l'heure, nous aimons toujours ajouter la sécurité, parce que la paix sans la sécurité n'est pas tout à fait suffisante. Pour nous, nous pouvons penser comme un grand auteur, un grand intellectuel africain, à savoir Saint-Augustin, a dit un jour que la sécurité est la tranquillité de la paix. Donc, pour nous ici, la paix va beaucoup plus au-delà, parce que si on rentre dans les concepts, on verra qu'il y a même des formes de paix qui ne sont pas tout à fait satisfaisantes. On parlait parfois de paix armée et autres, ou paix des braves, à partir de l'équilibre d'une certaine terreur. On le voyait bien durant la guerre froide. Donc, en quoi ici, la paix est une condition. C'est les organisateurs qui ont utilisé ces mots. Moi, j'aime beaucoup m'intéresser aux mots. C'est une condition. En plus, ils ajoutent indispensable. Ils auraient pu dire une condition pour une coopération sans ajouter indispensable. Ça montre toute la force, en tout cas, que les concepteurs de cette thématique ont voulu donner à ce mot. Or, quand nous nous interrogeons, effectivement, dans un premier volet, on se rend compte que, effectivement, si nous regardons en tout cas le continent africain, aujourd'hui, il est impossible de parler de coopération et finalement de développement, puisque je pense que le groupe ACP, c'est ce qu'il vise finalement, le développement des peuples et de nos États. Il est impossible de parler de cela sans évoquer la paix. Cela est vrai, parce que vous voyez bien, nous on connaît dans l'espace CAC des drames, en tout cas avec ce que vous avez suivi, notamment avec des pays comme la République centrafricaine, où l'État a eu à presque s'effondrer, où il fallait, où nous sommes en train de recommencer tout à zéro avec l'appui des divers partenaires. Donc c'est effectivement une condition indispensable à la coopération. Et ici, coopération veut d'abord dire coopération au sein des communautés économiques régionales, mais aussi au sein, à l'intérieur du continent africain et maintenant finalement entre les différentes entités, c'est-à-dire tous les États membres du groupe ACP. Comme nous l'avons toujours pensé, le groupe ACP, c'est vrai, a été créé pour constituer un groupe de dialogue, de négociation avec l'Union européenne à l'époque. Mais aujourd'hui, j'ai lu les documents qui nous ont été remis, où les organisations écrivent là-dedans que c'est le plus grand groupe d'intégration transrégionale. C'est des nouveaux termes même qui... Une organisation intergouvernementale, comme il a acquis ce statut. Et aujourd'hui, ça veut dire que au-delà du partenariat avec l'Union européenne, le groupe ACP doit exister. Et nous nous réjouissons de ce que, en lisant les textes révisés de ce groupe, la thématique de la paix et de la sécurité ait finalement été retenue dans le cadre de ces activités. Mais en retour, nous pensons également que il y a plutôt de la complémentarité entre la paix, la coopération et le développement. Comme la paix est une condition pour la coopération et le développement, nous pensons que la coopération et le développement sont aussi une condition pour la paix. Parce que, vous voyez, la nature des menaces que nous avons aujourd'hui font que d'abord, aucun de nos États membres, en tout cas je parle de l'expérience de la CAC et un peu de l'Afrique en général, son Excellence le président de la commission de la CEDEAO pourra me corriger si je me trompe, je le redis, qu'il nous semble presque impossible aujourd'hui pour nos États pris isolément de faire face seuls aux menaces liées à la paix et la sécurité. Cela veut dire qu'il y a presque une obligation à renforcer la coopération entre les États. De la même manière, nous pensons qu'il n'y a pas de paix durable. Parce qu'il y a des situations de paix. Si on prend la paix comme étant, au départ, l'absence de guerre. Mais l'absence de guerre ne suffit pas. Parce qu'il y a des gens qui vivent dans des pays où il n'y a pas de guerre, mais ils vont vous dire qu'ils ne sont pas en paix. Et c'est en cela que le développement vient maintenant jouer son rôle. Quand on mène à bon port des programmes de développement qui permettent de finalement satisfaire les besoins de la population, améliorer leurs conditions de vie, c'est une œuvre qui contribue à consolider la paix. Aujourd'hui, en Afrique, je parle essentiellement de l'Afrique et de l'Afrique centrale en particulier, nous avons de nouvelles menaces. Vous suivez tous l'actualité, vous savez que le terrorisme et l'extrémisme violent sont une grave menace à la paix et à la sécurité aujourd'hui et dans notre espace, qui était un peu épargné jusque-là. Nous avons ce phénomène qui s'est introduit, notamment avec les activités du groupe Boko Haram. Nous avons d'autres phénomènes comme la piraterie maritime dans notre espace maritime, le golfe de Guinée. Nous avons de nouvelles menaces également, comme nous sommes à la lisière, parce que la CAC a la particularité d'être la seule sous-région qui est frontalière avec toutes les autres sous-régions d'Afrique. Donc nous subissons en bien et beaucoup plus en mal tout ce qui se passe au niveau de l'Afrique. Ce qui fait que vous verrez tous les types de trafic que nous pouvons énumérer en Afrique sont présents dans notre espace. Le trafic de la drogue et des formes de criminalité comme le crime transnational organisé. La prolifération des armes légères et de petit calibre, les conflits électoraux, parce que ça, c'est des nouveaux types de conflits qui jusque-là n'étaient pas au-devant de la scène. Et la particularité même ici, c'est que avant on faisait face aux conflits post-électoraux. Maintenant, c'est des conflits pré-électoraux et vous suivez l'actualité dans notre espace, où avant même l'élection, les acteurs qui n'arrivent pas à s'accorder sur les modes d'organisation, les textes qui régissent, les institutions qui régissent ces élections, et ça aboutit à de la violence. Je ne veux pas citer les pays de notre espace, mais vous suivez l'actualité pour vous rendre compte que c'est un nouveau type de conflit qui n'existait pas jusque-là dans notre espace. Ainsi, l'Afrique centrale et l'Afrique en général font donc face. Et comme je l'ai dit tout à l'heure, heureusement que les pères fondateurs de l'OUA et aujourd'hui l'Union africaine avaient eu anticipé en créant non seulement une organisation continentale et en lui donnant les moyens de faire face à ces menaces, mais aussi en créant les communautés économiques régionales. Et ils se sont à Lagos, c'est une date très importante dans l'intégration africaine, le plan d'action de Lagos, qui a non seulement demandé de renforcer ces communautés économiques régionales, mais aussi d'en créer même là où il n'en existait pas. Et la CAC est d'ailleurs née dans la foulée de ces recommandations de Lagos. Donc, de manière globale, aujourd'hui, en Afrique, nous nous attelons justement à opérationnaliser ce que nous appelons l'architecture de paix et de sécurité de l'Union africaine, qui a pour pilier le système continental de l'alerte rapide, la force africaine en attente, tout ce qui est en opérationnalisation. Et il y a une des nouvelles idées qui émergent aujourd'hui, qui sont complémentaires, et je veux souligner ici la CARIC, c'est-à-dire la capacité africaine de réaction immédiate aux crises, qui, sur le plan technique, est complémentaire à ce que nous avions jusque-là, la force africaine d'attente. Et cette CARIC repose sur le volontariat des pays qui ont les moyens, au niveau du continent, de pouvoir mener des actions rapides en cas d'urgence. Donc la CAC est inscrite dans cette logique d'opérationnalisation de cette architecture de paix et de sécurité au niveau du continent. Et je suis un peu heureux que le président de la commission de la CEDEAO ait eu à prendre la parole avant moi pour effectivement revenir sur quelque chose qui est transrégional et qui est finalement primordial et prioritaire, non seulement pour la CEAC, l'Union africaine et les autres CE, mais aussi pour le groupe ACP, à savoir les défis du financement. Et effectivement, aujourd'hui, quand on prend l'architecture de paix et sécurité de l'Union africaine, aujourd'hui, on se rend compte que le financement est essentiellement extérieur. Or, comment on peut construire une paix et une sécurité durable et finalement un développement durable si on ne peut pas d'abord compter sur ses propres moyens? C'est un véritable défi. Beaucoup de CER en Afrique aujourd'hui n'arrivent pas, je pèse bien mes mots, n'arrivent pas à faire face à leurs responsabilités à cause de ce problème. Et or, nous avons toujours pensé que les solutions existent d'abord dans notre espace. Et c'est une tentation à chaque fois, quand on veut mener une activité, de regarder d'abord à l'extérieur avant. Je pense que ce 40e anniversaire sonne vraiment comme un moment indiqué pour repenser les modes de financement alternatifs. C'est-à-dire que si ceux qui ont toujours existé jusque-là, je m'excuse d'entrer un peu dans cet aspect du financement, n'ont pas donné satisfaction, c'est le moment. Parce qu'un anniversaire, c'est d'abord pour moi un moment de réflexion, un moment d'introspection et finalement de proposition pour pouvoir dire que le problème du financement de nos activités, de notre coopération dans les CER, au niveau de l'Union africaine, au niveau des ACP, est une épine dorsale pour les activités du groupe ACP. Or, selon nous, je vais terminer parce que ce n'est pas bon de parler longtemps, le contexte actuel mondial est favorable pour que le groupe ACP puisse émerger comme un acteur incontournable de la scène internationale avec l'apparition de nouveaux pays émergents. Et ainsi que les défis du monde contemporain. Donc, en conclusion, selon nous, il n'y a pas de coopération et de développement sans paix et sécurité. De la même manière qu'il n'y a pas de paix et de sécurité durable sans coopération régionale, sans développement. Au moment de ces 40 ans, l'âge de la maturité, nous pensons que le groupe ACP ne sera que ce que ses membres voudront qu'il soit demain. Nous remercions l'assistance pour cette attention.
We thank Mr. Elono for his intervention, and that of course put a different perspective on it. He came from a different perspective, I should say, and that is for peace and security. And all of us would agree that if there is not peace and security, or put another way and put it bluntly, if there's constantly being war and so on, that sap the energy and the limited financial resources which we have. And we can see that even today. So it's a very relevant subject in terms of our development, is a relevant subject in terms of our perspectives, as we have here, the regional perspectives. And for that matter, I want to pass the floor again to you to hear your comments, one on peace and security from the last speaker, as well as from SADC, who spoke on the progress that they are making, or the strides they are making in terms of that region. And the last one is ensuring financial sustainability for international organizations, the case for ECOWAS. So the floor is open for any comments. We have one,
two.
So we can call upon the representative from the EU first, yes, and then we have Congo, and I can't read that one, but
Namibia, South Center,
and the last one, we go in that order, and Guinea first. And this lady here, because we're some center. Okay?
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Vous avez bien fait de commettre ce lapsus lingué, de dire que c'est la Guinée. Nous sommes en effet le même et seul pays. Vous savez, alors même que j'écoutais les distingués intervenants, m'est venue cette phrase de Otto von Bismarck qui a dit. La seule chose qui ne change pas en histoire, c'est la géographie. Je trouve que c'est une phrase très profonde. La coopération régionale, elle est importante parce qu'elle s'assoit précisément sur des relations de bon voisinage. Ces relations sont très souvent, pour ne pas dire la plupart du temps, des relations historiques et qui font que ce qui préoccupe le voisin doit naturellement vous préoccuper aussi. Mais avant de poursuivre sur cette problématique, je voudrais, si vous le permettez, remercier très sincèrement le président de la commission de la CEDEAO, notre très cher président, puisque mon pays appartient à cet espace de la CEDEAO, pour l'éclairage qu'il a apporté à notre débat quant à la manière d'assurer la fiabilité financière d'une organisation. C'est un thème qui nous interpelle, nous, hein, au sein de la CEDEAO, des ACP. Parce que justement, comme il vient d'être dit, 40 ans d'existence, c'est assurément une occasion de célébrer, parce qu'on considère qu'à 40 ans, on a atteint l'âge de la maturité. Mais c'est surtout et avant tout une occasion de procéder, comme l'a suggéré le dernier intervenant, de procéder à une introspection. pour mesurer le chemin parcouru et se poser des questions. C'est ce que nous faisons ici au sein des ACP. Je voudrais remercier le président Ouédraogo pour nous avoir rappelé combien il est fondamental pour une organisation, quelle qu'elle soit, afin de garantir à la fois sa viabilité, mais surtout sa crédibilité, qu'elle mette sur pied des mécanismes susceptibles de garantir à la fois la prévisibilité et la pérennité du financement. En général, c'est la main qui donne, qui de l'index donne aussi des ordres. Donc, je crois que c'est une vérité axiomique ou axiomatique à laquelle on ne peut pas échapper. Donc, nous qui sommes ici au sein des ACP, nous réfléchissons depuis déjà beaucoup de temps quant à la meilleure manière d'assurer notre indépendance. L'un des chantres de cette idée, c'est précisément notre collègue de l'Afrique du Sud, qui n'a de cesse de nous rappeler que si nous devons, comme nous le suggérons, comme nous le voulons, nous réinventer, nous devons aussi emprunter d'autres voies susceptibles de nous conduire à une certaine indépendance, si tant est que l'indépendance aujourd'hui existe dans ce monde globalisé où c'est plutôt d'interdépendance qu'il faut parler. La notion de fiabilité financière, elle est très importante. Et je crois que ce que nous avons entendu va nous faire réfléchir davantage, parce que nous avons besoin d'asseoir la crédibilité de notre organisation, du groupe ACP. Le président Ouédraogo nous a indiqué quelques pistes, et je crois que cette piste est valable aussi, peut aussi susciter quelques intérêts de la part de nos collègues des Caraïbes. Le principe du prélèvement, des prélèvements communautaires, peut peut-être constituer une piste pour nos amis, dans la mesure où il nous a été dit ici par M. Marie que beaucoup de difficultés d'ordre financier constituent le bloc contre lequel se heurte toute l'activité à la fois au sein du CARICOM et du CARIFORUM. Donc merci Président Ouédraogo pour cet éclairage très utile. Maintenant, je voudrais m'appesantir quelques instants sur cette notion de paix que nous défendons tous. Comme il a été dit ici, vous rappelez, la paix est consubstantielle au développement. Paix et sécurité vont ensemble. Ce sont les doigts d'une seule main. Et je crois que nous savons qu'il est indispensable que cette paix existe, qu'elle soit préservée, qu'elle soit maintenue, qu'elle soit défendue pour pouvoir se pencher sur tous les autres problèmes de développement qui nous interpellent, qui interpellent nos États individuellement et collectivement. Donc, quand j'ai voulu tout à l'heure rappeler cette phrase de Otto von Bismarck, je voulais tout simplement dire qu'on ne peut pas, dans une sorte d'autarcie, se développer. On ne peut pas, dans une sorte d'isolement, assurer sa sécurité. Il faut coopérer, et cette coopération se fait au travers aujourd'hui d'organisations régionales ou sous-régionales. Je crois que c'est ce qui fait la force de la CEDEAO, par exemple, parce que c'est au travers de cette organisation que, par exemple, la paix dans mon pays est revenue. Et quand je dis la paix dans mon pays, j'y englobe aussi, j'élargis les frontières pour couvrir le territoire de la Guinée. Mais avant ça, il y a eu le Libéria, la Sierra Leone. Et je crois que dans la pratique, aux Nations Unies, on cite la CEDEAO comme l'une des organisations régionales les plus performantes et les mieux à même de répondre à cet impératif de coopération régionale en matière de maintenance, de maintien de la paix et de la sécurité internationale. Ceux qui sont familiers de la Charte des Nations Unies, et je crois que tout le monde l'est ici, savent quelle est l'importance qui est accordée au chapitre 8 de la Charte des Nations Unies, qui justement couvre cette matière de coopération régionale et du rôle qui est dévolu aux organisations régionales pour maintenir la paix et la sécurité internationale. Donc, je voudrais, en reconnaissant la pertinence des propos qui ont été tenus, me réjouir que nous puissions ici et maintenant avoir à l'esprit la nécessité de conjuguer nos efforts pour affermir davantage nos liens de coopération, de solidarité, pour pouvoir, en maintenant la paix et la sécurité, assurer notre développement. Je vous remercie.
I'm going to give the floor to the South Center first.
Thank you very much. Once again, apologies for taking the floor once too many times. Two sets of issues. One is I wanted to just reflect a little bit on the SADC intervention, which I thought was really quite comprehensive and very good, and the proposal around the industrialization, as well as the agricultural proposal, and in particular, I thought the food and nutrition declaration is quite important. I wanted to just point out that at the same time that we are proposing industrialization, which is also a critical thing for most ACP, we are in a context in the underneath the UNFCC framework. All of our countries are putting up what are called INDCs, right? Intended National Determined Contribution, under which we're making pledges around going carbon neutral, around going using clean energy, and all of those have implications for industrialization. So that there needs to be a twinning between what's happening in the RECs on the economic and trade sector and what's happening on the climate in the environment ministry. Because we are, on one hand, we're making a lot of commitments, or we're putting forward commitments about what we're going to do in terms of using less fossil fuels and all and a host of things, which have implications for strategies that are being determined elsewhere. So I really want to say that one of the things that we have to think about as we go forward is how we get more inter-ministerial and inter-body collaboration at the national level and internationally, because we have two sets of strategies that are going on, and that are going to be binding commitments that we're making that we're not sure of the means of implementation or funding, which will have implications for these strategies, especially around industrialization and agriculture, that we need to begin to think about. Also, just to flag, and again with the peace and security dimension, the gentleman didn't flag climate change, but climate change has been projected by almost all scientists and all of the national security agencies from Europe, the US, etc., to be a huge security dimension. And we know that climate change portends more conflicts domestically over water resources, over land, over food, and particularly in Africa, where we have projections. By 2015, agricultural yield due to climate change will be falling radically. We'd have implications for not only food security, but for trade, but also have implications for ethnic and other kinds of conflicts. So I think we need to put climate change in there as part of that dimension. And I'll stop there.
Right. I think that's this lady here. Madam, you have the floor, please. You have the floor.
Thank you, ambassadors, your excellencies, distinguished guests, Secretary General and Chairman, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I agree completely that peace is a requisite. And I'm Karen Che with International Bridges to Justice. So it will come as no surprise to you as when I say that access to justice is also a prerequisite to peace. And while we are here, I think, with the SDGs that are coming out and being finalized on access to justice very, very soon and very excitedly, what I'm more excited about, though, is that ACP has jumped the gun and figured it out beforehand and has already declared as a core priority access to justice. And so when I was hearing what does it really take to bring this vision to hope, like a real reality, I just wanted to affirm, even in the short time that I've been here this afternoon, the words of my brother who said, long live ACP, long live South-to-South cooperation. And in this way, we really are hopeful and excited to be invited into your space and looking forward to the ways that we can work with all of you in access to justice. Thank you.
I give the floor to Congo.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Président, je voudrais saluer le Président de la Commission de la CEDEAO, Monsieur le Président du Comité des ambassadeurs, Monsieur le Secrétaire général. Je voulais dire que c'est toujours avec un grand plaisir et un grand honneur de recevoir les anciens de cette maison, et qui marque, ceci marque la fidélité qu'ils ont avec la maison ACP, le président Ouédraogo Kadré, ancien de cette maison, ancien ambassadeur, aujourd'hui à la tête de l'une des organisations les plus importantes du continent. Je cite aussi l'ambassadeur de Trinidad et Tobago, que nous n'avons malheureusement pas connu, mais qui aujourd'hui refait surface dans cette maison, et bien d'autres ambassadeurs que je ne connais pas, à qui je présente mes excuses. Mais dans ce chapitre, je voudrais m'arrêter sur une personnalité très importante à mes yeux, le doyen Barry. Le doyen Barry, dans les années 90, nous autres, jeunes diplomates, nous venions ici, était en quelque sorte l'icône des ACP, que je le revois encore aujourd'hui ici avec son bâton. Vous savez, je suis touché, n'est-ce pas, pour revoir cette figure emblématique de cette maison. Et vous avez suivi avec quel brio, avec quelle pertinence il a posé les questions concernant l'avenir, concernant les ACP. Monsieur le Président, je voulais saluer et faire mienne l'intervention de mes préopinants, notamment le président Ouédraogo, lorsqu'il a parlé de la réussite du mode de financement de la CEDEAO. Vous voyez, le financement de nos communautés économiques et régionales, c'est évidemment la pierre angulaire, c'est l'épine dorsale, n'est-ce pas, de l'existence de ces communautés. Alors, je voulais saluer cette réussite de la CEDEAO et me tournant vers lui, dire ceci, simplement que nous attendons, nous avons deux organisations CER, la CEAC et la CEDEAO, qui sont très proches. Il y a beaucoup de similitudes, disons beaucoup de similitudes de langue, surtout de l'histoire presque commune. Et nous attendons fiévreusement la réunion qui a été annoncée pour ces deux organisations. Et surtout les conclusions que cette réunion pourrait donner, car en fait nous pensons que ces conclusions pourront booster notre continent. On peut même se permettre de rêver, Monsieur le Président, lorsque nous voyons que ces deux communautés mises ensemble se mettent à travailler ensemble, pourquoi ne pas rêver de la grande Afrique qu'a parlé Kwame Nkrumah dans la région Afrique de l'Ouest et Lumumba en Afrique centrale. Je crois que tout cela va dans le cadre donc de la reconnaissance des conclusions de Lagos, les recommandations de Lagos. Monsieur le Président, je ne voulais pas être long et dire simplement que cette expérience est attendue dans la mesure où aujourd'hui l'APE à la CEDEAO a été déjà est très très avancée en l'Afrique centrale. À cause de certaines, exigences ou certaines pesanteurs, nous n'avons pas encore pu signer. Bon, j'annonce aussi que le 19 juin, il y a une réunion du groupe de contact qui va avoir lieu avec l'Union européenne pour renouer le contact donc avec nos amis de l'Union européenne, afin que nous puissions suivre le pas de nos amis de la CEDEAO. Enfin, Monsieur le Président, c'était un peu les remarques que je voulais faire et dire simplement que Nous attendons beaucoup de vous et c'est toujours avec plaisir de vous voir aujourd'hui présider à telles organisations. Nous vous avons vu récemment encore avec notre ami Chambas dans une des grandes réunions en Afrique de l'Ouest. Ça nous a fait beaucoup plaisir parce que nous savons que vous êtes les pendants de notre maison ACP. Je vous remercie.
Thank you, Congo. We give the floor to the lady here.
Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I really want to thank you and I want to salute ACP for turning to maturity age of 40 years. I would like to express my own gratitude because 40 years is really a long time and you have a journey whereby you were walking and have a goal to reach, and I hope you are really going to get there. However, I have my reservation. I really also would like to acknowledge the challenges that are facing ACP countries at all levels, because I know that perhaps Europe do not actually want to shift their production capacity to ACP countries. However, we are really consuming their product. I would like to give an example for like automotive. All the presidents of ACP countries are using Mercedes-Benz, and they quite costly. And I don't know what is really their agenda there, because I tend to think that it's time now for ACP to define its agenda. Perhaps number one, to say no, we are consuming Mercedes-Benz, it's very costly. We want one production capacity to be in one of ACP countries. Of course, we have also cell phones. China producing cell phone, South Korea, US, and whatever. Perhaps it has to be placed on the agenda of ACP country to say, look, we are consuming economy, but please come and build in our countries. The other thing, what I would like to mention is that, yes, 40 years to me, it means a lot. However, I look at the history of Israelites. They were in Egypt, they were actually oppressed, and they suffered a lot. And then they went into the wilderness for 40 years. And Moses' leadership has actually to die for another leadership to come into being. And I tend to think that ACP have to raise up the Joshua generation that has to really demolish and actually conquer ACP's promised land. However, in this promised land, there is giants, the giants of corruption, the giants of oppressing women, the giants of misusing public money for personal consumption, the giants of illiteracy, the giants of drug abuse and human trafficking, the giants of using drugs among the young people. So these are the giants that are still occupying the promised land of ACP. And we need Joshua to take forth, be courageous and be strong Joshua generation to possess the promised land of ACP. Thank you.
We give the floor to Dr. Zondi. You have the floor, please. They're pointing to him.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the presentation. I just have one small little question to President Ouedraogo. I think it's a very sobering to see that there are some regions that are thinking very carefully about what might actually be existing within the continent that we might generate funding out of. There have been suggestions made about small little taxes for planes that fly over the continent, small little taxes on international shipments, shipping lines, and all of that around the continent. It's very interesting that the ECOWAS has is going ahead and doing this thing. Now, you mentioned a very important element, and I accept that there was not enough time to explain further, but I think it is pregnant with lots of opportunities for ACP, which was South-South cooperation. There are five ways in which South-South cooperation could contribute to us. One is providing additional financial markets from which to source development financing. The second one is investment markets for which you could encourage private sector to join in investment for FDI. The third one is technical cooperation and capacity building. The fourth is forming private-public partnerships with companies of the South, as it's happening in Angola, for example, in the area of agriculture. And the last one is development and humanitarian assistance. Now, I wanted to find out that from the experience of ECOWAS, when you say South-South cooperation, which specific South-South, concrete South-South cooperation has been found to be beneficial for now? So that we may see what may actually be learned by others, given the fact that the developing countries, emerging economies, are the only growing economies, and they are growing their share of development finance, generally infrastructure financing, and all of those things. It'd be nice to hear from you what's your experience. Thank you very much.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président, et permettez-moi, avant d'aller plus loin, de redire ma gratitude à tous ceux qui se sont exprimés pour les mots aimables qu'ils ont eus pour notre organisation et aussi pour notre région. Avant de répondre à la question spécifique qui m'a été posée, je voudrais revenir brièvement sur les questions de paix et de sécurité, pour dire que nous convenons tous qu'il n'y a pas de développement ou de perspective sans paix et sécurité. C'est la raison pour laquelle notre responsabilité première est de faire en sorte que la paix, la sécurité et la stabilité prévalent dans nos régions. C'est une des missions principales de la CEDEAO et jusqu'à présent, elle s'en est acquittée parce que son existence a permis de résoudre les crises, parfois même de les prévenir. Et en tout cas, d'établir la démocratie, la liberté, le respect des droits humains au centre de toutes les initiatives de développement, créant donc un environnement favorable au développement humain et au développement tout court. Donc ceci est très important, mais il est important de noter que la paix et la sécurité ne sont pas l'affaire d'un seul pays ou d'une seule région. Il faut une coopération internationale. On l'a vu récemment avec les défis auxquels nous avons été confrontés. Nous, en Afrique de l'Ouest, nous avons eu le défi de la crise terroriste au nord du Mali que nous avons eu à affronter. Nous avons actuellement la crise de Boko Haram au nord-est du Nigeria que nous devons affronter. Mais nous avons aussi le défi de l'insécurité dans le golfe de Guinée, l'insécurité maritime. Mais dans tous ces cas, nous avons bénéficié de l'excellente coopération internationale qui nous a permis de venir à bout de ces fléaux. La crise au nord Mali est contenue. La crise de Boko Haram est en train de faire des progrès avec la force multinationale que les quatre pays du bassin du lac Tchad ont décidé de mettre sur pied, appuyés par l'Union africaine et les Nations unies. Et je profite pour adresser mes félicitations à ces quatre pays pour la lutte résolue contre ce fléau qu'est Boko Haram. Alors, pour ce qui concerne la question que mon cher frère et ami, l'ambassadeur du Congo, a posée, et que j'ai plaisir d'ailleurs à retrouver, c'est quelqu'un dont je mesure très bien les qualités et que j'apprécie beaucoup. Alors, pour répondre à votre question, l'Afrique centrale et l'Afrique de l'Ouest coopèrent étroitement dans les questions de paix et sécurité. C'est vrai, nous avons prévu un sommet conjoint des deux régions à Malabo. C'était prévu pour le 8 avril. Mais le sommet a été reporté uniquement en raison des élections qui ont eu lieu au Nigeria. Mais nous pensons que maintenant que ces élections sont passées, les deux régions vont se rejoindre pour que nous puissions organiser ce sommet entre les deux régions. Les deux secrétariats, nous avons déjà travaillé, nos documents sont prêts. Nous n'attendons plus que la bénédiction de nos chefs d'État et je pense que ça sera pour bientôt. Je voudrais rappeler également que nous travaillons avec la CEAC en matière de lutte contre l'insécurité maritime dans le golfe de Guinée. Nous avons eu un sommet extraordinaire à Yaoundé en 2014 où nous nous sommes penchés sur cette question et actuellement nous sommes en train de mettre des structures efficaces pour faire baisser les risques d'insécurité dans le golfe de Guinée. Et cette lutte est en train d'avoir vraiment beaucoup de succès. Alors c'est dire que mon frère Alami et moi, nous correspondons très étroitement et nous nous verrons certainement la semaine prochaine à Johannesburg, au sommet de l'Union africaine, puisque les communautés régionales ont pour habitude d'y assister. Donc ce sommet viendra. Alors maintenant, pour ce qui concerne la coopération Sud-Sud, c'est vrai que pour nous, en Afrique de l'Ouest, nous attachons beaucoup d'importance à la coopération Sud-Sud, que ce soit d'abord en matière de commerce. Nous devons privilégier les relations commerciales entre nous, parce que c'est la meilleure façon de développer notre compétitivité et d'être capable de compétir avec les autres régions, les pays les plus développés. Alors, nos technologies sont proches, nos histoires sont plus proches, et nous pensons que c'est une source infinie, par exemple, de développement de commerce entre nos régions. Il y a également le domaine du renforcement des capacités, sur lesquels la coopération Sud-Sud est très importante. Je citais dans mon intervention l'exemple de Cuba. Nous travaillons avec Cuba pour l'éradication du paludisme en Afrique de l'Ouest par la production de biolarvicides, qui est un projet qui importe et intéresse les pays Sud-Sud, alors que les grands pays privilégient l'approche des produits pharmaceutiques, bon, qui sont très chers, qui sont très coûteux, alors qu'on peut éliminer la malaria par des biolarvicides. C'est ce que nous faisons avec Cuba et Venezuela également, puisque c'est une coopération tripartite, Afrique de l'Ouest, Cuba et Venezuela, pour éradiquer le paludisme en Afrique de l'Ouest. C'est un exemple de coopération en matière de renforcement de sécurité, en matière de santé, que nous pouvons réussir entre nous en termes de coopération Sud-Sud. Alors, il y a également des programmes d'industrialisation où il y a des technologies adaptées en Afrique, dans les coopérations Sud-Sud. Quand vous prenez des pays comme l'Inde ou la Chine, ils ont des technologies faciles à utiliser qui se rapprochent de nos environnements nationaux et qui permettent très rapidement de nous enclencher sur le développement industriel. C'est pour ça que nous devons protéger cette coopération Sud-Sud, en n'ignorant pas, bien sûr, la nécessité de nous ouvrir sur le monde entier, mais nous devons donner la priorité à cette coopération Sud-Sud. Je profite pour terminer pour dire que dans les négociations de l'APE que nous avons menées avec l'Union européenne, nous avons dit notre priorité numéro un, c'est d'abord, un, l'intégration régionale, deux, la création d'un marché régional viable et compétitif, avant d'ouvrir ce marché au reste de nos partenaires. Et trois, la dimension développement de ces accords, sur lesquels nous ne pouvons transiger, parce que les APE ne réussiront pas s'ils sont vus comme un simple accord commercial. Ils doivent être vus comme un accord de développement. Et nous devons insister sur cette dimension de développement, et c'est ce que nous avons fait dans les négociations de notre APE régional avec l'Union européenne. Voilà, Monsieur le Président, les quelques remarques que je voulais faire en réponse donc aux commentaires qui ont été faits autour de la table. Et je remercie les uns et les autres pour votre bienveillance et votre coopération.
Well, this brings us to the end of the panelists. There was one that was not here, so this brings us to the end of this discussion. And I'm sure you do not expect that I would be able to give you a summary of all of these things. I mean, I would have wanted to do this, but I can't do it. But let me say, though, we are in the ACP group, and all of these issues that are raised touch upon us in some way. And if nothing else be left with is, how can we bring these things to bear to benefit the whole group in some way or the other? That would be essential. And I say this because 40 years have gone now, and we are now going on to the 41st. So we have to do business differently. We have to ensure that we can make the second 40 years way better than the first. But of course, not only that, but we have to look at whether we want to continue the kind of partnership
that we have had with the EU all along. Of course, as I said in my opening remarks, we have the group on future perspectives which has delivered its report, and I hope you all read that because that has some fascinating recommendations there. And we are also looking forward to the eminent persons group. So in all, I think it has been a useful discussion. But we want it not only to be at just a discussion level, we want to see how best we can put it in practice. And if we can put some of these ideas in practice, we will be on to another level. So I thank all of you for coming and sharing with us in this 40th anniversary celebration. It continues tomorrow. We have some more, and we hope that you can be here with us tomorrow. It is even more, it starts from 10 o'clock, isn't it? So we hope you will be here. And before I finish, I would like to give the floor to our Secretary General for a wrap-up.
Thank you very much, moderator. We want to express our appreciation for you moderating it, but we want to express how much we appreciate, and you've paid us a great tribute in coming to share with us, and we continue the discussions tomorrow. What the ACP will be in the future is what you want us to be, and we are very, very happy and concerned to assess all that we do. That's why we too are scrutinizing, reflecting, with a view to moving forward and looking to the next 40 years where other generations will benefit from us. So we'll consolidate what we have gained, look to the new avenues, and that's why tomorrow is so important when we expose our discussions with our partnerships that we're already forging with India, Brazil, South Africa. When we have together also Turkey and the G20 wanting to share their concerns, and we look to how we can consolidate what is the new areas for our diversification and build on that so that we in fact serve our countries. But the regional pillars are fundamental, and it is clearly that regionalism now gives a dimension that was not present at the time in 1975 when we were almost in the shadow of the non-aligned movement. And that has faded away or has become more confused. But the strengthening of the regional process and regional integration strategies that are formulating will be important pillars on which we can build and move forward. So we look forward to continuing our dialogue, and our conversation is also to put into practice. But we have some time for enjoyment and to appreciate the cultural richness of this ACP group. But Madam Moderator and Mistress of Ceremonies, what is next on our agenda?
All the way from the South Pacific, we have the ukulele player, joined by our lovely lady from Tuvalu. So they'll be playing this instrument. He'll be playing the instrument called ukulele, which means jumping fleas in English. But in any case, enjoy the sun, the palm trees, the lovely rhythms of Pacific. And we have here Hati Sanft, accompanied by Fatia from Tuvalu. Ladies and gentlemen, a big hand before we leave here. Pacific.
If anyone knows the song or the words, please feel free to sing along.
Thank you. Merci.
Palau Bito.
Wow. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that was the Aparima dance, a dance of love, danced by our very own Fatu. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us here. May we direct you to Walubilis to continue with the cultural celebrations. The reception is waiting for you. More music is waiting for you. So let's see you there within the next half hour, 1 hour. You're most welcome. Thank you. You have some papers.